To the VNRC meeting. I'm the VNRC Chair Elizabeth Erickson. We've got some more members over here, John McKee, Bill Callahan. I don't know if we have anybody online yet, so it's not.
No.
Oh, Suzanne Norwood. So we're doing a little bit different format tonight. We're going to have four speakers. And then we're going to do a panel discussion at the very end. So what I'd ask everybody is just, let's just hold questions till the very end. We'll have everybody up and we'll answer questions at the very end. So first off, we have Mark Thompson, who's Vice President of Environmental Affairs for Montana Resources, and he's going to talk about the Butte Mine Flooding OU Water Treatment Process. And then we've got Dr. Alicia Cox, who's going to talk about increased treated Berkeley pit water discharge impacts speciation and bioavailability in a restored ecosystem. And we've got Nathan Cook, who's going to talk about 100 plus years of Clark Fork River fisheries investigation. And Caleb Yearling is going to talk about the state of the fishery in Silver Spring. So thank you all for coming and talking with us.
Elizabeth?
Yeah.
Is it all right to ask us clarifying questions as they go on?
Yeah, I think so, you guys.
I have some questions for you, Monica.
And you guys have probably been through this before, but this meeting is being recorded both audio and video.
Yeah.
Great, thank you.
I just wanted to tell you how all this came about is we had other speakers lined up for this meeting, and they kind of all crawfished on us at the last minute. So made a couple of calls, and I sure appreciate you guys answering that call. Mark has graciously decided to come tonight and talk to us. He's given this presentation before to CTEC, and I was very impressed with it because I worked over there in water treatment for 7 years, and it's a complicated process flow. And I think Mark's done a masterful job of getting it to where that system can do just about anything they want. And I was really impressed with that. And then Alicia's doing her study with Juan and Paul. Could you guys all raise your hand? And Juan, when do you defend?
In July.
Okay, awesome. And Paul, you're still pulling stuff together, so it's a year or more out?
First year PhD.
Okay, gotcha.
Juan.
So they're monitoring the stream conditions since they started discharging from the polishing plant. And I think, I'm not sure if Alicia and Mark have been in the same room together before.
Right.
Yeah, so part of what we were trying to do is to get all these people, all these stakeholders together to try and exchange information. And then with that, Nathan's been with NRD now for a year. Before that, he was the fisheries biologist for FWP on the lower Clark Fork. And then on the upper Clark Fork, we have Caleb Yearling. Caleb's been here now 3 years, Caleb?
Yeah.
Okay, three or four. And so these guys know the secret handshake for the fish, and they're going to talk to us about how they're doing in Silverbow Creek and the Clark Fork River tonight. So it's kind of one big download, same topic from very different angles. So I just thought it would be a great information exchange, and appreciate all you guys coming out tonight. I know you probably had better offers. So, thanks for putting up with us tonight. So take it away, Mark. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, thanks, Brad. Appreciate it. And thank everyone for coming here tonight. I told a few of you earlier, I'm getting ready for a flow trip on the Smith River, and I spent most of the day dealing with that instead of getting prepared for this. So. But I've done this enough times, I should be able to get through with an air treatment. So,
try going the other arrow.
Okay, here we go. So, back in late 2019 and early 2020, I got around and talked to a lot of people. I don't recall coming to the BNRC, but a lot of other groups. But a project we initiated in the Butte Mine Flooding Operable Unit, which includes the Berkeley Pit and the bedrock groundwater aquifers under Butte and surrounding the Berkeley Pit. And we started this project 4 years.
That's good.
We started this project about 4 years Before the BMFOU CD would have otherwise required treatment and discharge of Berkeley pit water. Because there were a lot of unknowns out there, and the system that size, you don't want to get right up to the last minute and figure out that you got a big problem. So we started early. The major goals for the pilot portion of this project were to determine if we pump on a Berkeley pit, and a lot of people think the protective water level only applies to the Berkeley pit, but it doesn't. There's about a dozen surrounding points around the Berkeley pit, including mine shafts, that all have to stay below the protective water level. And they are all higher in water level than the Berkeley pit. So it was going to be one of these outlying points of compliance that was going to trip the protective water level well before the Berkeley pit went out. So if we just pump on the Berkeley pit, what happens to these outlying points of compliance? Are they still all well connected and they all respond, or do we have to go out and deal with these points of compliance individually? The other one is, we have been treating Horseshoe Bend water or Horseshoe Bend area water, since 1996. We knew we could treat that water and treat it very effectively, but what about treating that water and Berkeley pit water on top of it? And while those two waters are quite similar, there's also some subtle differences in treatment needs. So what do we need to treat the water to discharge standards and reliably? And finally, kind of not a super fun priority, but a mining priority, is this system now allows us to control how much water we store in the Yankee Doodle tailings impoundment. And that has significant implications in dam safety issues. So the less water, the more safe the dam is. So in the past, all we could do is regulate how much water we had in the dam by how much water we brought in from Silver Lake. Now we can actually regulate water, like on a year like this, where we know we're going to get a lot of run-in water, we can actually manage it with discharge. So that was one of the goals. We wanted to reduce the inventory storage and then manage it at the level we wanted it. So we started the discharge pilot project in 2019. Since then, we've discharged about 7.2 billion gallons of water to Silver Bow Creek. We pumped and treated about 4.3 billion gallons from the Berkeley pit. The difference being previously inventoried water in the tailings impoundment that also has been discharged. So controlling the elevation of the Berkeley pit, we knew we could do that. The pumps are in the pit. We knew we could do that. But, we've drawn it down over that period of time, about a half a foot. Now, keep in mind, our goal was just to prove we could maintain it. The goal wasn't proved to drop it or let it rise. And the Pilot Butte mine shaft was the highest bedrock compliance point in the system. And even though we dropped the Berkeley pit by a half a foot, we dropped the Pilot Butte by a foot and a half. So the responses are not necessarily intuitive as to you only dropped the Berkeley pit by half a foot, but outlying points dropped a foot and a half. So interesting response. But what about the other points of compliance we had? So you see the little red pluses there. That's the point we started pumping and discharging. So the Berkeley pit flattened out. This is the Anselmo. That's the second highest one. It responded nearly immediately, and as did the Pilot Butte. Well G is on here because Well G is a compliance point. It's a bedrock aquifer monitoring well, not connected directly to any of the underground workings. So that was one that was in our mind, that is the bedrock going to respond the same as the underground workings? And it's hard to tell from this graph, but it didn't respond as fast as these. And we were for about 6 months kind of biting our fingernails what it was going to do. And then it turned around and flat, like this hockey stick looking thing. So that was good. All the points of compliance responded and are holding a relatively flat point or getting drawn down slightly.
Could you tell us where Well G is located?
So Well G is south and east of the Berkeley pit. not too far from our main gate, Garchek. So how are we doing on the treatment front? Okay, so every day we discharge, we have to collect a 24-hour composite sample. Goes to the lab. The compliance parameters we're looking at are arsenic, cadmium, copper, iron, lead, mercury, zinc, pH, and TSS. So if you tally that up since September 2019, that's over 1,250 samples we've collected of the discharge. And times that by 9, you get roughly 11,500 compliance tests. We have not exceeded a single parameter on that list over that period of time, which is, given just inherent lab variability, you'd think the lab would throw us something once in a while. But I think we're so far down below the compliance point that even lab variability doesn't pull us up above that standard. So I think on the treatment side, I think we have very effective treatment. We're definitely able to show compliance with all our parameters. So this is a big success. So on the third point, drawing down the inventory and Yankee Doodle tailings impoundment. In 2019, we started out with a little over 34,000 acre feet of water. 2022, last year's survey, we were at 21,000, a little over that. This year we only do a survey, a bathymetric survey, once a year in June. We're probably going to be in that, probably feet range in that world. And we're getting down towards our target of about 15,000 acre feet. That's where we're probably going to stop discharging water in excess of what we're treating. Okay,
John? Is that the clear water?
Yeah. That's the pond.
The far end.
Yeah. So, and as I said earlier, it's a big important factor that we're able to control that volume of water as accurately as we can now with the discharge system and then the use of Silver Lake water. I think I want to jump back up here because this is an important point. When we get down to that target level and the tailings impoundment, what we're going to be more looking at discharging is more somewhere between 1 and 3 million gallons per day. We're discharging between 5 to 8. We've been up as high as 9 million gallons a day in the past. But that's to get rid of that inventory. Once the inventory is gone, the discharge flow rates are going to go down. The other thing is when you look at these storage volumes, we've got tremendous storage capacity. If you compare something like our system to like a metro sewage treatment plant, they have no storage in front of them. They have to treat, discharge everything that comes at them. We don't have to do that. We can shut down discharge anytime we want. We've got this storage. We've got about 4 years of water storage in the Berkeley pit if we don't want to pump the Berkeley pit. We don't want to pump it today. We pump it twice as much tomorrow. No big deal. This system is different than most any discharge systems around because we have this massive storage capability. And we have the ability, when we get down and we only need to discharge on an average of 2 million gallons per day, we've got the capacity to discharge up to 9 million gallons per day. So we've got the capacity to make up the storage, and then we have the storage that we can utilize. So it's a different system. So, and why I'm bringing this and making this a big point, probably what you're going to see in the future, we have a wet year, a wet spring like we have right now, pretty good snow load. If it started raining and we started getting a lot of water, we're going to start we would, if we weren't still in the pilot project and we were just normal, we would just discharge more water. Well, the creek already has a lot of water in it. So when the creeks are flowing fast and high, that's when we also have to get rid of the water. And I'm not talking like we're going to add to a flood event, but when the creeks are flowing, that's where we're going to discharge. When it's hot and dry and we're in drought, we don't need to discharge. We may actually have to pick up Silver Lake water use to keep our water balance at the mine. So we won't have to discharge. So when the creeks are low, slow, dry, and hot, we're not going to discharge because we don't need to. That's kind of counterintuitive. What I think people are looking for out of this project, whereas we can supplement the creek with more flow and cool water. We can't. Our water is going to be hot when the creek's hot. And it's not going to be cool. So. And we're not, you know, one of the things, there's a couple of things we've learned that weren't really on our list. The things we anticipated were going to be problems turned out not to be problems at all. And the things we never even considered as being problems are turning out to be problems. Things like bacteriological activity in the tailings impoundment pond. We had a big algal bloom last year. We couldn't filter out the algae and we didn't want to send it through the RO units. So we had to shut down. A couple of weeks ago, we had to shut down the polishing plant because we had bacteria growing in the multimedia. So we had to bleach it and clean it out. We never anticipated things like that. And last summer, Caleb and AR and MR have been talking quite a bit about last summer, hot stream flow temperatures, what's the tailings impoundment doing with temperatures? Because we got a lake temperature regime in the tailings impoundment, creek temperature regime that's oscillating day and night. The pond just gets hotter. That's all it really does. It doesn't cool at night. We thought, well, the creek's cool at night, let's discharge at night. Well, that kind of, unbeknownst to us, that kind of screws everything up because those fish are looking for that relief at night. We hit it with hot tailings impoundment water. It doesn't give them that relief they need. And then on top of that, we're shocking the system with our water because this is another thing we learned. We can be a big discharger in a very little creek, which means we can have severe influence on what's going on in that creek. So on off, like we did last year, that's no good. So I think what we'll see into the future, when the creek's hot, low flow, we're just not going to be a player. We'll just shut down discharge. Probably best, and as I said, we've consulted with Fish, Wildlife, and Parks, probably best just, we can't help, so let's make sure we don't hurt. Other thing is, when we turn on and off, let's not do it, slam that valve shut, boom, it's shut. Let's taper it down. When we come back on, let's not just hit it with 9 million gallons right away. Let's bring it up slowly. Let those fish find different areas for refuge and adjust. So we're learning a lot about that that we never expected was ever going to be an issue that we were going to have to deal with. So there's a lot of learning lessons we've had that aren't on our objective list when we started. So a lot of people, when we started the pilot project, this was kind of our slide, and we try and point to all these things, and we call this the spaghetti diagram. But this is where water's going around a property. So as Pat said, I thought we had confused a lot of people with the spaghetti diagram. So let's take it and make it very visual. I'm going to walk you through step by step where water is, how it gets from A to B, what is the flow, how's it routed from A to B, and then what happens at each step. So we're going to start with the scenario. We're going to be pumping Berkeley pit water in this scenario, and we're going to take it to the Horseshoe Bend Water Treatment Plant, which is our current configuration. That's what we're doing right now. So down around in that circle there, there's a pump house. It starts with some floating barges. That's what gets it out of the pit lake. The barges pump it into the pump house up here on the bank. Whoops, wrong one. Up here on the bank, this is the pump station. Inside the pump station are these pumps. And these pumps right here are Hazleton Vertical 10 MS pumps. And they're very special pumps because they can deal with Berkeley pit water. They're made out of 3/16 stainless steel. It's very expensive and very hard to machine to close tolerances. These are what they call high head, high volume pumps. Okay, so we can pump a lot of water a very long distance and with a lot of elevation gain. These motors, these are 500 horsepower motors. So what we have in this pump house is we've got two of these Hazleton 10 MSs. One's running, one's a hot spare. So if something happens to this one, there's one right behind it, right back here. We just switch over, okay? We can get about 5 million gallons a day out of the Berkeley pit with one pump. So from that Berkeley pump house, we get it out of the pit, we take it up to the copper precipitation plant. This is where we're gonna get the copper out of it. And that looks like this. This is actual Berkeley pit water coming in over the scrap iron right here. And what happens when that water, that high copper water sees that elemental iron, the copper in solution swaps itself with the iron, the elemental iron, and the iron goes into solution, and the copper comes out as elemental copper. Okay? When we go in there, we scrape that tin out, we put it on a shaker table with high pressure jets, and we wash that copper off kind of as a little bit of a, it's a, like a sludge. And then we take it over to the mill, we filter press it and blend it in with our other concentrates and send it out to market. Coming out of the precip plant, we got two lines that come out. And those lines go two places. One line, one pipeline can bring it all the way down here to this area right in here. The other one, we can just release it straight into this pond system coming down. We prefer to bring it down separate from the pond and the pipeline to a pump we call the P116 pump. A P116 is its computer control designation. That's what the computer calls it, so that's what we call it. So here, oh. So here it is coming out of that pipeline into a sump right here. This is the pump picking it up. Just another shot of the pipeline discharging, shot of the pump. And from that pump, and I'm zooming in a little far on my aerial photo here, so it's getting a bit grainy. But from that P116 pump right here, it comes in a pipeline and it goes into the Horseshoe Bend Water Treatment Plant right here. We also have a valve where it can come over here to another treatment system that we call the Horseshoe Bend Capture System. So we have an option. This water can go here, or we can actually split portions to go either way. So we've got maximum flexibility of where we're treating water. So in the Horseshoe Bend Water Treatment Plant, the water comes in to a reactor vessel. This is a very high energy environment. We blow a lot of air in there. We've got big mixers rotating in the bottom, and we're trying to stir everything up. So technically speaking, the Horseshoe Bend Water Treatment Plant is a two-stage line precipitation, high-density solids water treatment plant. And so two-stage means we're going to adjust the pH to our target pH in two separate stages. This is stage one right here. There's an identical stage called stage two. Stage one, we bring it up from, if this is Berkeley pit water, from a pH of 4 to a pH of 7. Stage two, we go from 7 to 10.5. And that allows us to target removal of certain parameters at optimum levels. It's not really important in the treatment system right now, but it turns out there's some, actually, because we have two stages, there's a lot of rare earth recovery potential out of those two stages. So it may come into being very interesting. So from the reactor, it flows over to the clarifier over here. So this is high energy. We're trying to get things to hit each other, even at the molecular level. We want things to strike each other. When I say it's a high density solids plant, if you just bring the water in, hit it with line, bring the pH up once, clarify it, let it go, discharge the sludge, you're only going to get sludge less than 5% density. So 5% of the sludge you're getting rid of is actually solids. If you take that sludge and recycle it back into the plant, add the lime to it, and then put it in your targeted treatment water, all those, even though it's only 4 or 5% at that point, now you have solids. Once you get solids, you have surface area. Once you have surface area, you accelerate the kinetics of your reactions. In other words, your reactions happen faster. And not only that, the solids grow bigger. So when you send it over here to the clarifier, those solids settle out faster and you get clearer water come over the top. What we're targeting, this water went into this vessel and came out looking like that. So we removed all the solids and make it look like that. We made it clear. The better we can remove the solids, the denser those solids are, the faster they come out, and the clearer the water we get. So if you go with a low density solid system, you get less than 5% densities. This is probably running above 20% density. So we're the sludge that we waste goes to the Berkeley pit. Not all water treatment plants come with a Berkeley pit. So sludge management at a lot of water treatment plants can be a big deal. So you want the denser sludge, less volume to work with, less problem you have. This is a completely automated system. Our operator can sit here. Pat was a water treatment plant operator for a long time. Operator can sit right at this console and control any parameter in the plant. So from the water treatment plant right here, the effluent, after going through stage two, is now pH 10 and a half, comes in here and hits this pipeline. So when the tailings go up to the tailings impoundment, they go up as a slurry, about 35% solid, 65% water. We essentially, the tailings impoundment is a giant clarifier where we separate the solids from the water. So then once we separate the solids from the water, we bring the water back down to the mill in a continuous recycle loop. So we got about 20 million gallons a day recycling through the tailings pond. So we take the treated effluent from the water treatment plant, we put it in the return water line, comes down to the mill. From the mill, it gets incorporated in that slurry. It's now going up to the tailings impoundment. So it's used as part of that 65% water going back up to the tailings pump. So when it gets up here, and this is what the slurry looks like when it's discharged out into the tailings impoundment, we've got our treated Berkeley pit water to pH 10 and a half going into the tailings impoundment. So that we accomplished the goal. We got the treated water up to the tailings impoundment. So next, our other stream of water that needs treatment is this horseshoe bend area seepage water. And this is a combination of water. This area here is where the old Silverboat Creek channel came through in the valley. So all the water coming down through, you know, whether it's the Northwest dumps up by the Granite Mountain or out of the tailings impoundment or to the east, hits that native ground, flows essentially to that point right there. And that's horseshoe bend seeps. But once it flows through that waste rock, it's not very good water anymore. So a couple of photos of, you know, the big seepage area right here is, you know, some water flowing. This horseshoe bend, any of you have been back in that back corner, that's what it looks like. So we start collecting it in this series of ponds coming down here. So that it's separate from the 116 pump. Those two are separate, but they're very close to each other. And then we divert it, comes in here, and it diverts under this haul road over here and this diversion structure. Right upstream of the diversion structure is this weir that the Bureau of Mines and Geology monitors for horseshoe bend area flows. This is looking back up the pond towards the source water. And then it comes under this haul road right here and into this, what we call the equalization basin, which looks like this. This is the water coming in right here. This is the influent pump house. So a couple of close-ups of those two. These are the pumps in the influent pump house. They're long vertical pumps. I think these are 150 horsepower each. And then those pumps, from those pumps, we can either direct the horseshoe bend water to the horseshoe bend water treatment plant, or in this particular case, we're directing it up to the horseshoe bend capture system. And this is the horseshoe bend capture system pump house. So in that horseshoe bend capture system pump house, you see some of our pumps buried. They're the identical pumps that we have down in the Berkeley, but these are 800 horsepower motors on them because we're lifting it higher. So these are these pumps. This one sitting on the ground right here is $500,000. And we got a bunch of these pumps everywhere. So here again, normal operating configuration, we have one pump running, another hot standby. But if we, when we have to go to maximum flow on this, we can do 8 million gallons per day of water treatment in just this one system. We need both of those pumps running. So we're right here in this boiler, we're installing a third pump. So if we have to go to max flow and have two pumps running, we have a third hot spare up here. That's what this pump is going to get installed right up here. So the picture of the pumps, pump house, flow meter, so we can keep track of how much water is going through the system. So out of that pump house, just some close-ups. Here's a rotating assembly, the impellers. This is a pen, by the way, just to give you scale. This is the housing. Here's that one on the floor. And all this piping in here, since this is untreated water, you know, all this piping in here has to all be 3/16 stainless steel. In fact, you know, even the welds, the welding rods have to be 3/16 stainless. So very difficult material to work with. So out of the horseshoe bend capture system pump house here, we're lifting it all the way up. These are the tailings lines coming up from the mill right here. This is a booster station on the tailings system. This is the booster station for the capture system. It's identical to this system down here. So this system only has to lift it from here, and then this pump house lifts it the rest of the way. So when it goes into the tailing system, goes in, this is the horseshoe bend capture system pipeline coming in, goes into this manifold. These are the tailings lines coming up from the mill. So the process control computer system knows exactly which tailings line has the extra lime. So one of these tailings lines, let me back up, I got ahead of myself right there. One of these tailings lines has extra lime that we added down at the mill to neutralize and treat the horseshoe bend capture system water. The process control computer knows exactly which line has that lime in it, and it'll open a valve up here and direct that water into that supercharged tailings line. Now this looks kind of simple, pump the water up the hill, inject it in your tailings, you know, and it is, but it's also very effective. It's very effective because in these tailings lines, we got 50,000 tons a day of ground up rock in a very high energy environment. So we've got this incredible amount of surface area for reaction. So when that horseshoe bend capture system water hits that tailings with that extra lime, those reactions are happening right now just because of the high energy and high surface area. All the reactions we're talking about love to occur on surfaces. We're giving them lots of them in a very high energy environment. So it actually turns out to be a very effective treatment system. And then from the injection point, it gets discharged into the tailings. And as John had said earlier, in the tailings, we've got essentially two areas. This area right here, we call the beach. That's where all that ground up rock from the mill settles out. And then the clear water decants to the back.
And your goal is 15,000 acre feet of clear?
Yeah. So when we started this project, this pond was out here. And now look how small it is. That's what we want. We want a small pond.
Right.
So we want a small pond that's away from these embankments. When we started, the pond was up in this area, near this embankment. Now we pushed it back that far. It's a huge dam safety issue. So this is actually a really good project from a dam safety perspective as well as remedy perspective.
So downhill is basically off the right-hand side of the picture?
No.
That's downhill.
Yeah. So all these creeks coming in up in here, this is Yankee Doodle Creek, this is the Silver Bow Creek. They all came together right in here and then flowed down in Silver Bow Creek. So now we've got the Berkeley pit water up there treated, pH 10.5. We've got the horseshoe bend area water up in the tailings impoundment, treated 10.5. And what we saw when we started this project Because this is the best water we have on a property, including the Horseshoe Bend Water Treatment Plant effluent. And this meets all of those parameters I showed you in the beginning, about 99% of the time. And what we saw is our standards are based on total recoverable metals. But what we saw is we always met dissolved metal standards, which means when we're not meeting a metal standard, it's being carried on to particulate. So when we get to the polishing plant, oh, there's tailings discharge. Okay. Oh, maybe I jumped ahead. Sorry. Anyway, so up here, we've got a return water barge pump. So it pumps it up on the hill and the gravity flows all the way down to here, which is before we put in the Horseshoe Bend Water Treatment Plant water. We split it off and we take it over to the polishing plant over here. So now getting back to why we need a polishing plant. The only time we didn't meet our standards were when total was above and dissolved was below, which meant we had a particulate carrier of the metals. So when we get to the polishing plant, well, here's where the water splits on the return water line coming down. Very sophisticated. If it goes this way, it goes to the polishing plant. If it goes this way, it goes to the mill. It took a lot of engineering. I did that myself. So first thing we wanted in the polishing plant is we wanted that extra insurance to meet standards of having extra filtration, filter out that particulate that's carrying the metals. So we've got basically these giant vessels full of multimedia, anywhere from gravel to sand to fine sand to anthracite. The other thing is we got water that's 10 and a half, which is great for metals removal, but not something you want to put in a creek. So we got to reduce it down to 7.2. We do that by bubbling gaseous CO2 into the water, makes carbonic acid drops of pH. We also have some reverse osmosis capacity there for calcium and sulfate. Basically, this is to meet standards for our whole effluent toxicity test for the water flea Ceridaphne dubia. They don't like calcium. So in order to meet that, you have to have low calcium. We get everything up to the tailings impoundment. For the tailings impoundment pond does the real final treatment. Most of these reactions we're talking about can occur on the order of minutes to hours, except for gypsum saturation. Calcium sulfate come together, form gypsum, falls out. Gypsum, it's plaster of Paris. It's the same thing in drywall. It's not a horribly bad thing, but too much of even a good thing is too much. That to come to complete reaction for gypsum saturation, you need weeks to months of retention. Nothing we can get out of the water treatment plant, nothing we can get out of the capture system, but we can get it out of the tailings impoundment. So that's the key to getting everything up to the tailings impoundment, is bring the calcium sulfate down. So everything you've seen before it gets to the polishing plant, MR is the operator of those systems, even though we're partners with AR. At the fence line to the polishing plant, we pass it off. They're the lead operators of the polishing plant and the discharge. So just a couple of photos. This is the discharge point down by the Chamber of Commerce building. And for some reason, we designed this that if you get over about 7 million gallons per day, it comes out the top. I don't know why, but it's kind of cool looking. These are the multimedia filters, these big white vessels in the back. You can see they're tall. There's a guy right there. So they're, you know, 10, 12 feet tall. These are all the piping manifolds to it. And then this is a set of RO membranes right here. So that's what we got in the polishing plant.
And the water circulated through those membranes?
Yeah. So RO works. It's a semi-permeable membrane. You pressurize the water, it pushes the water through the membrane, but any molecule bigger than the size of a water molecule gets rejected by the membrane. So then you have this brine stream that you also have to clear off that couldn't pass the membrane. So each one of those is its own one time through. But you need, it's high pressure, energy intensive and it's real slow. So you need a lot of these, need a lot of these individual tubes to get any amount of total flow.
How long does it take to later to get from one end to the other of these tubes?
All those tubes?
In the treatment process.
On the RO or the total?
Yeah. You said it was slow, I mean.
Yeah.
That's like a day or?
Well, you know, think about trying to push something through, you know, cheese cloth.
Okay.
You know, it kind of dribbles through a little bit.
Yeah.
And that's essentially what you're doing, but at a molecular level. So it, you know, dribble, dribble. Well, but I don't know the answer to that.
Yeah, that's fine.
You know, what the capacity of a single tube is. Well. I don't know, Pat, if you want questions, I probably droned on a bit long. We're doing later.
Anybody? Thanks, Felicia. Thank you, Mark.
Right, thank you.
Where you lay your auto.
Is it this?
Yeah, top one. Thank you, Mark, for, I hadn't heard all of the details about collagen plants, so it's really good to hear all of that. So this is some work that we've been doing for a while. And this is part of Juan's thesis. And Juan will be defending in July, so we'll have final results for you more in July. This is kind of the preliminary stuff that we've put together and looked at here. So lots of people in the lab have worked on this.
Yeah.
All right, this one's not going to go back. And so we'll go through a little background. I'll flip through some of this a little bit fast because everybody won't need all this. But chemical speciation is what does something look like in a drop of water? How is our copper there? Is our copper copper plus? Is our copper complex with oxygen? Is our copper complex with hydroxide or water? And so how a species is complex or what it's speciation is, it helps organisms either take it up or not. So thing, different factors affect chemical speciation. Everybody knows about iron. Iron 2 is going to be soluble. Iron 3 might be insoluble in solutions. So bioavailability is the ability of an organism to take up a contaminant, to take up a nutrient into a living organism. And every organism has different parameters for bioavailability. Between different microbes, between organisms. So this is an example of our environment. And sometimes organic matter, pH, temperature, water composition are going to have an effect on what is bioavailable. And sometimes things are going to be adsorbed to a surface of an organism and some things are going to be absorbed. And so how this makes a difference is things are taken up into an organism and then they may be toxic or they may be nutrients as well. So that's kind of what the end goal of what we're interested in. On the left is intracellular, on the right is the environment. And so this is just showing you that uptake of organism or uptake of metals can be complicated. There are all sorts of different values. It can be complex to a ligand, it can be not complex to a ligand, it can be reduced, it can be changing. And so it gets very complicated depending on your organism. Each one is different. Metal toxicity examples. I don't think we need to talk too much about these, but when you take metals in, you can have different variable types of toxicity occurring. Copper sulfate killed, you can use this to kill organisms. Lead affects humans' nerve systems. Nickel can be cancer. All right, so the main topic of today. We're skipping historical background for this audience. Everybody knows what's going on in our creek. Here's some pictures of from 2002, and then our nice meandering system that is restored from 2013. And we just heard all about the discharge system in the polishing plant. And we have October of 2019, but maybe it started in September. So we'll have to get with Mark on when the discharge exactly started.
So we were interested because we knew the conductivity increase. And we thought that the calcium and sulfate might affect the chemical speciation of different chemical species in the stream, which can affect the bioavailability of key nutrients to organisms. So we're going to check that out overall. All right, where did we look? So our control is at Thompson Park, all the way up, and we use that as a control. Let's move that here. And then we come down to town, and we're above discharge by the KOA there, and by some of the wells. Below discharge, as we call it, Slag Canyon's right there next to the monitoring station by Montana Street. Santa is now where Santa Claus roads cross the creek, Miles Crossing, because people are interested in like any groundwater upwelling that might be occurring down there. And then we have our German Gulch, above German Gulch, Silverwood Creek below German Gulch, and then German Gulch itself, because I was interested in the fish species that got isolated up in the German Gulch originally. And so what is happening above and below that, I thought was going to be interesting there. And then we go above Warm Springs and below Warm Springs ponds. We didn't want to get too much involved in those ponds because those are incredibly complex. I think picking a sampling site when we go out once every 3 months would just not give us too much information. So we go above and below Warm Springs pond. And then to get the effect of Little Blackfoot, we have Garrison. And then we have where Flint Creek comes in by Drummond, which is also interesting. So these are the sites that we go out. We sample every 3 months. Here's our control, Blacktail Creek. There we are sampling it in the winter. And here's our discharge point. So two of our points are above and below the discharge point that Mark told us about. Here's a zoom in of Butte Area 1 sample. So above our discharge is over here by the KOA, and then discharge, and then right here is Slag Canyon. There's some sampling occurring out there. This looks like water bio, collecting samples to get organisms off. Our Silver Bow Creek samples, Santa Claus Road, Miles Crossing, German Gulch above and below, and then we sample German Gulch as well. The Upper Carp Fork, and as well as Silverbow Creek, because this counts as Silverbow Creek right above Warm Springs. We just call this Three Bridges and the Trestle. Warm Springs is right below the Warm Springs settling ponds, Garrison, and Drummond. So how does he do this? You're looking at four time points here. So fall of 2018, winter 2019, spring of 2019, summer 2019. Discharge begins October 2019. And then four sampling time points after discharge, fall 2019, winter, spring, and summer of 2020 is what you'll be seeing here today. We do the aqueous chemistry, take meters, conductivity, temperature, pH, dissolved oxygen, and then we measure turbidity and chlorophyll as well with a meter. This one up here, aquaflora. In the lab, so we collect water samples out there. Everything is 0.2 micron filtered. So dissolved fraction, 0.2 micron filtered. We do major cations and anions. We recently got an NSF MRI funded, Measure Research Instrumentation. So we have this, we have this instrument in our lab now. We can run cations and anions in one channel and organic acids on another channel, which is really cool. We run dissolved inorganic carbon and dissolved organic carbon over at the Bureau with Jackie. There's an Aurora carbon analyzer and a power for isotopes as well. And the trace elements we run with Jackie Timmer at the Montana Bureau of Mines and Geology. She runs that for us. We do geochemical modeling. We use EQ3, and then if you do water-rock interactions, it's EQ6. And Arizona State has designed a portal, or it's called a worm portal, water-rock organic microbe, where you can really easily access the program EQ3, which makes modeling lots of samples much easier and more streamlined as well. So that's an interface to EQ36. It's also an NSF project. Okay, so take the data. Do some measurements, run it through some computer modeling to get our aqueous chemical speciation to figure out what is going on. So this is the part that I think you're all interested in. So we'll go slowly through this part here. Preliminary results, what do we see? We'll show you cations or conductivity, anions, cations, some trace elements, and then a little bit of chemical speciation. And we'll have all of this nice and final in July. This is what Juan has been working on. So conductivity is water's capability to pass electrical flow. The more stuff in your water, the more conductivity there is. In Yellowstone, as you heat water up, the conductivity increases, you cool the water samples down, and then the conductivity actually decreases. So Juan has made all of these slides. This is his presentation that I'm giving. And so all of these great slides are Juan and not me. So, you know, he animated the conductivity. So this is the above the discharge, the KOA site. This is below the discharge, Slag Canyon. This is the start of the discharge. So time before discharge increasing, discharge starts, time after here. And so the conductivity above the discharge and below the discharge, before and after, shows that it is higher. And most of that discharge, as Mark said, it's going to be calcium and sulfate. This is the storm drain that is kind of next to Dickies. I always forget the name of it. It's SS something. I always forget the name. All right, so then we're moving downstream a little bit here. So this is going to be below Butte Area 1, which is Santa in yellow, Miles Crossing, Silver Bow Creek above German Gulch, Silver Bow Creek below German Gulch. The red, the red is our control. That's Blacktail. And then this here is German Gulch. So as you're moving downstream, we're still seeing increased conductivity in the sample sites as you go downstream. Another one, this is above Warm Springs in yellow, below Warm Springs in green. And so you'll see that above Warm Springs, there's going to be more conductivity than the samples below Warm Springs. So pink and purple are Garrison and Drummond as you go down. And so you can see this effect pretty much all the way down to Warm Springs for the most part, before the discharge and then after the discharge. So the effect is seen all the way to Warm Springs Pond, and then below Warm Springs Pond, the conductivity has decreased. So, yes.
So that line, which looks like it's more like in December, the discharge started, you said in October?
October of 2019.
I would think that would be, I don't know, close to, not so close to 20 January. You know, it's hard to see, but I'm curious why the conductivity goes up if it's anticipating the discharge and the creek couldn't have known that.
We just had this huge discussion about this in lab meeting Tuesday. So this is an artifact of how I'm graphing it.
Okay.
And so we decided to graph it by, so we had measured at the discrete points here, and I think it was probably hard for Juan to animate dots. And so wherever you see these, this is a discrete point where we've measured.
Right.
And so we decided to connect them with a dotted line, implying that we're not monitoring in between. And so therefore, if we actually drew this for what actually probably happened, right, then this sorry, I'm going backwards. So I guess that is a good one to look at, but you'll be able to see this one. So if we took a sample here and then after, this really should be hop, right?
Right. But what I was curious about is why it's already going up before. If you go to that one that you actually was clear where the data points were. That one.
That one. Okay.
How did that yellow one know it was supposed to go up already 2 or 3 months before they're discharging water?
Oh, so we could look at that one and compare it to all the other seasonal changes. So the thing that I didn't say on here so this is kind of the our winter season,
right?
This is our fall as well. So something else would be going on during that one.
Like it's warm and low water. Like low water would tend to have more black in it.
Well, we can look at the other, so there's we have a conductivity plot later.
I'm distracted.
Okay. That we can look at, and sometimes you do get seasonal changes like this one, and I don't know exactly what that is, but we can like double check and see, you know, if that happens in a seasonal change, which can happen. We put that plot at the end because it was being weird, and now show you that. So this is all of them together. Here and again, we have time on the x-axis. These different shadings are the different seasons. And up here we have Butte area. The middle is the Silver Bow Creek area, and the bottom is the Upper Clark Fork area. And this is just all of the data together. So if you're looking up above and below the discharge, this is where you would look. And this is everything together on the same plot. The before and then after. All right, major anions before the discharge. So we've got our halogens up here, and then bromide, chloride, fluoride, and then these are our nutrients down here, nitrate, nitrite, phosphate, and sulfate here. And so from upstream control all the way downstream, to make it easier to look at, that is above the discharge and below the discharge, so KOA and Montana Street here. And then anions after the discharge, we have increases. And there's above the discharge here, below the discharge as well. And so we see that this is an increase in sulfate, mainly from the discharge water. Major cations before the discharge from the control all the way down to Drummond. Focus in on above the discharge, below the discharge, KOA and Slide Canyon. Ammonium, calcium, lithium, magnesium, potassium, and sodium. Let me measure on our IC, our ion chromatography system. After the discharge, we have increases in calcium. And if you focus on above the discharge, KOA, below the discharge, Slide Canyon, we have increases in the calcium. Muscle lifting things. So these are some of the new data people haven't seen yet. Okay, so let's go to the Bureau, measure some ICP-MS. What elements can we get using inductively coupled plasma mass spectrometry? Kind of the periodic table, right? So these are the things that aren't as abundant. So we have lower detection limits to measure these. And so we have been looking at these elements and looking for trends in them. So this is, these are the trace elements on the same scale. And we're gonna zoom into a better one here. And so this is just showing that when everything is in nanomolar here, so you can think of nanomolar as it's similar to ppb, except you have to divide through by the mass of the element for people that think in ppb. And so molybdenum and strontium, we see on this scale, and all these other elements, palladium, rubidium, selenium, titanium, vanadium, and tungsten are here. So now each element is on its own scale. Here, again, these are still in nanomolar. We have all of these plots in ppb at the end of the presentation for people that think in ppb. You can look at them later that way. And so we see that different elements are increased after the discharge. So molybdenum increasing after the discharge, palladium increasing after the discharge, selenium is increasing after the discharge. So again, these plots are on time. The colors again are the seasons, and each one of the lines are the different locations from all the way from German Gulch, or sorry, from Thompson all the way down to Drummond in here. Strontium increase after discharge, titanium increasing after discharge, tungsten increasing after discharge. Vanadium is kind of crazy. We're still to piece out vanadium, see what's going on with that. Okay, another set of trace elements, silver, arsenic, boron, cadmium, copper, manganese, lead, and zinc, all on the same scale. So nanomolar again, we see the manganese and the zinc. Let's zoom in for each element. Now these are all on different scales, still on nanomolar. So kind of ppb plus divided by the mass of the element. And so we have arsenic over here, cadmium. Cadmium in general, we don't get very many data points, so it's usually below detection for the most part. Copper doesn't seem to be increased in the discharge. And manganese seems to be zinc, although there are other trends going on with zinc in the past, so we have to look more at that. And then a couple of hits on lead. We tend to not get a lot of lead numbers in general as well. strontium for the fish guys here to look at. So this is strontium and PPB here. And so this is showing that strontium has increased after the discharge. And so as Nathan will probably tell us, this can have an effect on fish otoliths in their ear bones. So you can do different isotopes, stable isotopes of that. And so this could have an effect on what's happening with measurements in fish ear bones. And Nathan can tell us. Okay, one of the things we noticed was selenium in the water. So this is in PPB. The MCL is 3.1 for selenium. And this is before the discharge. We have selenium numbers down here. After the discharge, our selenium numbers creep up. We've only had one above 3.1 PPB, but selenium could be something to keep an eye on, perhaps. So this is from a paper that thinks that this is minimal effect with selenium. This is low effect with selenium, moderate and high effects with selenium. And so we're creeping from no effects of selenium to maybe some effects on selenium. Selenium is a toxic element. There is one weird amino acid that does have selenium in it, but maybe something to keep an eye on, something we can discuss. Okay, we're just going to see some chemical speciation from two time points. So summer 2019 before the discharge, fall 2019 after the discharge. And we're just going to see copper and manganese. So again, we're looking right here, above discharge, below discharge, one time point before and one time point after. Okay. I apologize for these being up here. I found it wasn't, yeah. These are the labels. So from control all the way down to Drummond, this is the chemical speciation. So what's our copper doing when you model it? How's it present? Up here, the complex is a carbonate. How's it complex? And so before the discharge, above and below Sly Canyon, we have similar speciation perhaps where most of it is a carbonate complex and then some of it might be an oxide. And then after the discharge, focusing on this, this is speciated a little bit similarly to before, but maybe there's a pH difference, which gives us a different monospeciation. And then we have more copper 2 plus that could be a pH sort of thing. And so if you just kind of ballpark look at this, what you see is this species is less present after the discharge in the same condition. There's also a seasonal thing here, so we have to look at this more to see what's going on. Manganese chemical speciation before the discharge. So again, control all the way down to Drummond. Let's look at the KOA in the Sly Canyon. Here's the speciation for manganese. And then after the discharge, zooming in. So different speciation overall in manganese before the discharge and after the discharge. And again, these are seasonally different, perhaps. So we'd have to look into that as well to see if it's not a seasonal effect as opposed to discharge effect for these particular elements. And we can look at the speciation for any of those elements that we were showing. Okay, so future work. Juan's going to be finalizing all this stuff and writing his thesis madly, depending in July. If anyone wants an invite, let me know. You get an invite to Juan's defense. He'll speak more slowly than me, and he'll explain things better than I will at the beginning. I'm just zoomed through the beginning. And I want to show you a little bit about some of the other work that we are doing that are related. So with funding from this body, the VNRC and the Natural Resource Damage Program, we were able to get metagenomes from these locations in Silver Gulch. And these are earlier data. So these are from November 2015 to November 2017 locations. And so with these metagenomes, a metagenome is all of the DNA that you can extract out of a sample. So we take a sediment sample or a water filter, extract all the DNA and see what's going on. And we used a program, we found 17 new, totally new microbial genomes in our data, which is cool. There should be more, but we found 17, which is pretty interesting. And then Paul, who is here, you can talk to him more. He's been actually analyzing the metagenomic data in a couple of different ways. One is looking at particularly the copper genes in there, and he'll be able to tell you all about using our geochemical data, modeling it with our microbial data and finding correlations between like copper and the organisms that are there, which is really cool. And now we're going to talk about today. The other thing that you can do with these data are communities. So what sorts of organisms are there? We actually have an NSF proposal in right now because we think we can use the community data combined as a like a global health metric for streams, which is really cool. We noticed that the ratios of nitrous fiber kind of tell you if there's a water treatment plant around. And then different ratios of the beta proteobacteria indicate the degree of contamination or effect a site has, or impact has been on us, which is actually really cool. And it's really interesting. We'll keep you updated on that more soon. Okay, so what we kind of told you today so far was that you've seen the conductivity increase drastically after addition of the treated water into the creek. It's mainly the calcium and the sulfate is the major. And then we've seen manganese, strontium, selenium, titanium, vanadium, molybdenum, tungsten, and lead concentrations rose after the treated water discharge. We think the chemical speciation has changed a little bit in Silver Bowl Creek and the Upper Clark Fork based on geochemical modeling of the aqueous species. And then selenium concentrations reached the minimum hazard index after the discharge. So that might be something to keep an eye on with the discharge. And then if you want to get some rare earth elements out of the discharge, it looks like palladium might be one of the ones to go for, Mark. So, this work couldn't have been done without all the students in the lab that go out and sample with us as well. So all the students in my lab learned how to sample on the creek. It's kind of like boot camp for Yellowstone. So if you can go out and sample on the creek with us, then you can do Yellowstone. February is a particularly brutal sampling trip for some people. So all of these students have helped with sample collection analysis. Jackie Timmer measured the ICP-MES samples for us. These are some of the references for just some of the intro stuff that we have. For more info, we've got limitations of photosynthesis. These are theses from out of my lab, master's theses on the digital commons. So Isaiah Robertson, this is almost getting submitted to Frontiers Environmental Science soon. I have to change a couple graphs and be good. And then chemical speciation, if you want to see more on that, that's Jonathan Feldman's thesis and hand worked on basin wild rag contents as well. These are some of the students, the alumni over here. Actually, Amelia needs to move over here. I didn't get to that. And then our undergraduate researchers as well. This was Juan's Texpo poster that was being presented this afternoon. So as you can see, I pretty much flat out stole all of his, very nice plots to put into our talk today. And then this was Paul's poster at Texpo, I think best PhD project he got. And then he passed on the Texpo cup to Bailey Phillips.
Yeah.
I hear. Okay. Exactly. So Paul won Texpo last year for his master's project and he created a like Stanley Cup, but for Texpo. That's great. There's that. And then this is going to load. So this is a bunch of conductivity data and that's kind of the end, but it wasn't loading. So I moved it to the end and it sure, it's the conductivity plot one. Right. It's really big or something. And it's not loading. Yeah, okay, so it doesn't load. That's weird, but this is some cool conductivity that you can look at trends by season because it's bar charts. I thought people might like to see it, but I don't know if we're gonna get to see it because I don't know if it's gonna appear or not. So that's what I've got for you. And after other people talk, if we need to go look at more data, we can. And things are in PTP for people too after this. Okay, that's it.
Questions?
Sure. While we're switching here, yes.
You know the concentrates you were talking, do they exceed the federal and state levels?
So
you know them.
We're going to be looking at that for Juan's thesis now. And so the only one that we know about so far is that one selenium point.
So you don't have data if they exceeded that.
We don't have that yet because the copper and zinc standards are based on hardness, and we didn't quite dig into that.
Okay.
But we'll be looking into that and have a better idea in July. But really, it's only that one selenium point so far that we noticed. That one's forward, that one's laser. The bottom one's laser, that one's laser, that one's forward.
Okay.
Yeah, that was doing very terribly in that.
Good evening, everyone. My name's Nathan. I'm here to talk to you about fish today. I thought we might talk about the status of the fishery of the Upper Clark Fork River, but before we talk about the current status, it's sort of where are we going, where we're going. I think we need to look at where this fishery has been in the past. How did we get to where we are today? So maybe we can understand what's going on. Oh, I knew I had to do it because everybody has to. That's a fact. So I'm going to take you through a little bit of a timeline of going back to the first, you know, sort of modern scientific fisheries investigations on the Clark Fork River. Talk about different eras, like talk about the post-Warm Springs ponds era, because the ponds were very important to the establishment of the trout fishery. The damage assessment era, so the restoration remediation era that we're currently living in down on the Clark Fork anyway. Talk a little bit about the current studies that we're involved in on the fishery, and then what's next in terms of science, fishery science for the Clark Fork River. So in terms of the fisheries timeline, I'd be remiss not to talk about, you know, the native peoples that live in the Clark Fork River area and the deep understanding, the deep relationship that those peoples have with the fisheries in the area. They probably understood well what species were there, what time of the year, and where they can find and fish for them. But like I said before, I'm going to focus on more modern scientific sort of studies, and it's sort of interesting to think about almost all of those studies are done in order to understand the damage that we've done to that once pristine resource and some ways that we can undo some of that damage. So, you know, going back to the earliest scientific studies that I could find in the Clark Fork system were studies done by the U.S. Fish Commission that would later become U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. So the first report I could find was by a guy named Barton Everman, and Mr. Everman went and sampled fish all over the Rocky Mountains, started in Texas, actually, went all over the Rocky Mountains sampling fish and visited streams like Silverbow Creek and the Clark Fork River. And he looked at Silverbow Creek, saw that, you know, in the 1890s that it was already heavily impacted. It had a lot of tailings in the bed, it was fine sediment, and there was nothing living there. Went down to Deer Lodge, did a bunch of seine netting, couldn't find any fish down there either. And the sort of barren wasteland sort of condition continued for, you know, 60, 70 years, where Silverbow Creek and the Upper Clark Fork were basically fishless. Then in the 1950s, the Warm Springs ponds, which were originally started in the early 1900s, they were upgraded and expanded in the 1950s. Pond 3 was built. And the liming operation was expanded, more lime was getting added to aid water treatment. And that increased water quality to a point where trout started showing up in the vicinity of Deer Lodge. And we know that because there's local reports, but also the first electrofishing study was done in 1957. Those results were reported by a guy named J.C. Spindler.
It's John Spindler, and he was the first environmental manager for Anaconda as well. He went on to be hired by Anaconda Company.
Yeah, I don't know if he was working for something called the Montana Public Health Bureau or something like that, but
Department of Health and Environmental Science.
At that time, it was like a public health board or something like that. So that first report was to them for some reason. Then he became a biologist for FWP and then went and worked for Anaconda Company. So he had an interesting career path. But he was the first person to use crude electrofishing gear in the Clark Fork. And they also used explosives to sample back then. Actually, some people still use that. And imagine you could get explosives and gear pretty readily back in those days. In 1959, Anaconda Company experienced a labor strike, and that disrupted mining operations and also the water treatment operations. And that led to a degradation in water quality, particularly downstream of the Warm Springs ponds. 1960, there was that pretty big fish kill. There was dead fish all the way down to Missoula. As part of that, there was a first cage fish study that I'm aware of was done. They put these hatchery rainbow trout in these cages and they only lasted 96 hours. At red water. So, you know, the strike passed, electrofishing gear sort of progressed to the point where it more effectively captured fish to the point that, you know, Fish and Game could effectively capture fish and do population estimates. And two of the sections where they started doing this early on were the PH Shack section, which is here just downstream of Warm Springs, and the Williams Tavener section. And I'm going to talk about those specifically on the next slide, but it's interesting to think about many of these same sections are the same spots where Caleb still works every spring. He's out there. We're at Williams Tavener this week. Yeah. So they're still doing these every year. So there's a good long data set for a lot of these sections. So these, I promised you some data from Williams Tavener PH Shack. So these two graphs are showing population trends for brown trout. So on the y-axis, you're looking at trout per mile. You're going to see a lot of trout per mile graphs. Over time, over years. And that blue line indicates a change in the water treatment in the Clark Fork system. Actually, the closed water treatment system was built in Butte in 1972, and that system became the primary source of water treatment in the system. Whereas before, Warm Springs ponds were the primary treatment source. Now the ponds became kind of a secondary water treatment.
You know, Nathan, in that change in 72, that was Spindler again. He was having them make changes here in Butte.
Yeah, I can see why they hired him, because he apparently had a pretty strong understanding of the system.
Yeah.
But you can see, so that in these closed circles are the PH Shack section, and the open circles are the Williams Tavener, and the upper chart is the fall estimates and the bottom chart spring estimates. You'd see after that treatment system was installed, there was a big bump in numbers, particularly at the PH Shack section, to the point where it's reaching, you know, over, I can't even read my own graphs, but you know, over 1,000 fish per mile by the 80s. And that sort of ushered in this heyday of brown trout in that upper part of the upper Clark Fork River. So those charts I just showed you, as well as this stuff, is from a report by a guy named Ken Knutson. And did this report in 1984. In the early 80s were, you know, the era where CERCLA and Superfund were still fresh. And so it's kind of reading the writing on the wall and seeing that there may be a Superfund type claim coming to the Clark Fork River. So we went out and looked at fish populations in the Clark Fork River and compared those to nearby tributaries that were, you know, not as impacted by mining. And on the map on the left here, kind of broken the river up into reaches A, B, and C. A lot of you probably know that refers to, but reach A goes from Warm Springs to Little Blackfoot River. Reach B goes from Little Blackfoot to Flint Creek. Reach C is from Flint Creek to Rock Creek. But so in this table, he was kind of comparing numbers at PH Shack, for instance, in the spring and fall. You compare those to area tributaries like Rock Creek or the Blackfoot. It's not too bad. I mean, 1,100 fish per mile in the spring, 1,900 fish per mile in the fall at PH Shack. And that's the average from 79 to 83. So, you know, 4 or 5 years. Yeah, it's not too bad. But as you move downstream, you know, the numbers kind of peter out, and including that Williams Tavener section, you know, more about 200 fish per mile. And those densities are pretty close to what we've seen in more recent years in that part of the river. And that also is true for those Reach C sections down at Bonita and Bearmont. You can't read that. It's, you know, 39, 38 fish per mile. So really low trout densities down there in Reach C. And that's continues to be the case today. And it's something that FWP and myself spent a lot of time thinking about and actually researching, why are trout numbers so low down there? We still haven't fixed it. Spoiler alert. The other thing that Knutson did in his report is he showed that in general, trout density is, or trout diversity is pretty low in the upper Clark Fork River, so. These LLs up here, those refer to brown trout. LL is Loch Laven. It refers to the strain of brown trout that were stocked in Montana. And then you have rainbow trout, EB or eastern brook trout, DB for galley barking, and cutthroat trout. And you can see that brown trout are by far the most dominant trout species in the upper Clark Fork. And that, again, is true today. Whereas, you know, Blackfoot has a lot more diversity, as does Rock Creek and other tributaries. And that's partly to do because of mining advantage. So I mentioned that sort of, you know, those early super fun days. Well, of course, out of that became a series of litigation and some settlements. But going into those settlements, the state did a damage assessment. And part of the damage assessment was looking at injured aquatic natural resources. And there was a lot of lab work and field studies that went into that. And for the report that came out of that, you know, they documented injuries to resources such as surface water, sediment, benthic macroinvertebrates, and fish, specifically trout. And they did things like they took macroinvertebrates from the Clark Fork River that was laden with metals, and they fed them to fish in the lab and saw how much nuggets they took up. And so generally what came out of those studies is they found that fish in the Clark Fork River are experiencing conditions like the Clark Fork River experience things like lower growth, increased mortality, increased metal concentrations in their tissues. That's what this chart is showing here. It led to things like tissue damage, stress responses, and ultimately reduced densities that I talked about on the slide. So in general, you know, it's thought that trout densities in the upper Clark Fork are thought to be about 1/5 to 1/6 of those reference streams because of mining contamination. At least that used to be the case. So I just gave this talk last week in Missoula. Part of my talk was going to talk about Silverwell Creek. And Silverwell Creek, you know, was of course one of the first spots to be remediated and cleaned up. Caleb's going to talk about Silverwell Creek in his talk. So I'm going to just skip ahead, well, in my mind, downstream to the upper Clark Fork River. This is a picture taken by Sydney Stewart, one of my fellow NRD people, Caleb and crew electrofishing on that PH Shack section, which again is just downstream of Longstrom Creek. And this was on the 11th of April. I know that because I was out there. And again, this is a site that's done every year now by these guys. So we have a long-term data set. It's also a site that was the first one to be remediated on the upper Clark Fork, you know, other than Silverboat Creek. Downstream on the Clark Fork itself was the first one to be remediated. Remediation was completed in 2014. So it's a spot that's had a lot of time to recover. You can see the height of these willows, for instance. Things like undercut banks forming, providing some habitat, as well as overhanging vegetation. So from a physical habitat standpoint, it looks pretty good. And it's also, because it's been cleaned up, it doesn't have those exposed slickens that we know cause issues farther downstream on the Clark Fork. We've had recent fish kills related to runoff of the buffalo slickens. That shouldn't be an issue in the extension. But when we look at the actual data for that site, it looks like the population is not doing very well. So, okay, we can look at it. Brown trout per mile on the y-axis over time. And you can see that, you know, back in 2013, for instance, population is doing pretty well, you know, over 1600 fish per mile. But around 2015, 2017 time period, it's just gone into this sort of consistent slump. And, you know, it's sort of punctuated by 2023, the latest estimate that Caleb and his crew just completed, 25 brown trout per mile, which is as low as it's been since that 1972 water treatment conclusion. So, you know, really low historic numbers. And It does seem that these low numbers are, they're really the case upstream of Deer Lodge and those upstream reaches that, FWP, samples, and it's not so, downstream of Deer Lodge, populations are much more, close to average. And the same is true for, you know, nearby tributaries, so here are two tributaries, the Upper Clark Fork River, the top shows the little Blackfoot, what we call the FAS sections, most downstream section on Little Blackfoot. You can see that that population's been relatively steady over time, bouncing around 1,000 fish per mile. On the lower graph here is Warm Springs Creek on the WMA, which again is pretty far downstream. It's actually pretty close to that PH shack section, you know, geographically. I'm sure that there's fish that swim from the main Sun Clark Fork River into Warm Springs Creek. So if you sort of squint your eyes there, you can kind of see maybe a decline in that population in Warm Springs Creek and lower Warm Springs Creek over time. But it hasn't been nearly as dramatic as what's occurred in the last, you know, 6-7 years on the Upper Clark Fork River. So what's going on? Well, we don't know exactly, but we do know that it's related to what we call recruitment. And when we say recruitment, basically means small fish surviving and growing long enough to be large fish. So in our case, large enough fish to be captured in FWP surveys. And generally speaking, you know, those electrofishing on a system like Clark Fork River, FWP is only good at catching H3 fish and bigger. So H3 fish is the smallest fish that we get our hands on reliably. So one of the things that we found is really an important predictor of number of H3 fish that show up in these electrofishing surveys are flows. And so we developed a model years back using minimum flows to predict number of H3 fish captured in FWP surveys. So that's what this chart is showing. Calling H3 recruitment as percent of average. It's basically just the number of fish captured by FWP that are H3 during the spring surveys. And those years on those data points are the year of the FWP survey. And then minimum flow is on the x-axis. And it's not minimum flow the year that FWP is out there shocking. It's minimum flow 3 years earlier. So minimum flow conditions when those fish were very small, young of year, and perhaps that they're most vulnerable to environmental conditions. And so that minimum flow for about 13 years or so was a really good predictor of H3 recruitment. We have really good relationships there. And, you know, that's was important from a restoration standpoint because NRD program, along with our partners, Tribal Limited, FWP, others, are doing a lot of work to try to get more cold clean water into the Clark Fork. And you know, this model would say that's a really important restoration goal. However, in more recent years, we've seen this model fall apart and my lovely model no longer works anymore. And recruitment has been consistently low, regardless of some pretty good flow years. So, you know, I think 2023 is a good example. Where we should have had really great recruitment up here, you know, 400-500% of average, because 2020 which was 3 years ago, was a really great flow year in terms of minimum flows. And that's this little guy here. There's not a big dip like on these other years where minimum flows kind of bottom out. 2020 was even better than 2018 and 2011, which were you know, amazing flow years. But story is, we're not getting any small fish, regardless of really favorable flow conditions. So there's something else out there that's driving recruitment and driving it down. Another way that we've looked at recruitment is through something called otoliths microchemistry. And otoliths are fish ear bones, essentially. They're located right behind the brain. And you get an idea of how big these things are. Each one of these little white specks on these pucks are otoliths. These pucks are one inch in diameter. So these are all holding odorless that have been prepped and mounted in epoxy for this analysis I'm about to talk about. Tracy Elam did all this prep work. He's with FWP. He's a whiz at prepping odorless for this kind of studies. But the way it works is if you take one of these things and polish it with a little sandpaper, you can see growth rings, which work very much like a tree ring. So this chart in the middle, you know, a drawing of an odorless showing those growth rings, and each one of those rings represents a year. So you can tell how old the fish is, for one thing, by looking at these things. But we can also use precise sampling techniques, in our case, a really tiny laser, to sample the bony material that makes up those odorless. You can look at the chemical composition of that bony material, and it'll be directly related to chemical composition of the water that fish is living in. So it doesn't work for all chemicals, but it works for strontium, which Dr. Cox mentioned earlier. Strontium behaves very similar to calcium in the way it's taken up into bones. So it turns out it's a really good marker in doing these kinds of studies. In this example, we're looking at the strontium isotope ratio across, as we move that laser across our otolith here, and we see it change from sort of the outer rings, so that's when it was old, the fish was older, to the inner rings when it was younger. So in this case, this fish lived in a tributary in its early years up until about age two, showing a strontium signature higher when it was in that tributary natal area. And then the strontium signature changed, just moved into the main stem Clark Fork River, where we captured it later with electrofishing. You compare that to a fish that spent its whole life in the main stem, that strontium isotope ratio just stayed the same. And just stays the same across the whole otolith. So, you know, using this technique, we could pretty precisely assign fish to different natal areas in the Clark Fork and its tributaries. So that gave us a really good idea of what the recruitment source is. What are the sources of small fish into the main stem Clark Fork? And we use that information to prioritize areas for restoration actions. But since we've had this basic collapse in recruitment, since this study was originally done in 2016, 2017, we've decided to replicate this study to see if, you know, those tributary and main stem sources have changed. For instance, one of our hypotheses might be that we've completely lost main stem recruitment. On the other hand, maybe tributary recruitment and main stem recruitment has declined in equal proportions. But in either case, I was really interested when I saw Dr. Cox present the strontium data earlier last fall, because possibly this, you know, the strontium isotope ratios have changed in the main stem Clark Fork River itself in response to the discharge. Another recent study that's been going on is a food web and fish community study. And this is something we've been working on with University of Montana, in particular, a PhD student named Taylor Gold-Kiras. And her PhD project has a whole variety of different aspects to it. But one of the things that she's really digging into is what is the fish community, you know, beyond just brown trout, which I've spent, you know, most of my talking about till now. What does the fish community in general look like going up and down the river? And so one of the things that's coming out of the study is the importance of mountain whitefish, which there's some of those little guys up, striping guys up in here. Mountain whitefish are by far the most abundant large body species in the Clark Fork River. And they're arguably, you know, very ecologically important in responding to, you know, stress and mining and those things in their own way. So one of the things that coming out of the study, we need to pay more attention with what's going on with whitefish. This is one of Taylor's graphs. And what she did is basically correlate brown trout abundance to mountain whitefish abundance. And what she found that in these, you know, three different reaches, reach A is in the black dots, reach B is the red dots, reach C is in the green dots. At least in reach B and reach C, brown trout numbers and whitefish numbers were really tightly correlated. What does this mean? Why does this matter? Well, what it means in reach A, where we've seen this big decline in brown trout numbers, the whitefish numbers have also declined. So whatever's affecting the brown trout is also affecting mountain whitefish. And probably other species. We just don't have the data to necessarily make these kind of relationship. So that helps us rule out, you know, certain limiting factors, certain factors that might be impacting multiple species rather than just one. So what about the native trout? We talked about brown trout quite a lot. What about the native West Slope cutthroat and bull trout? Well, those species are pretty much limited to spawning and rearing in tributaries. They don't really spawn or rear in the main Southern Farmville River that we know of, whereas brown trout do that quite regularly. So they're spending a lot of times up in tributaries doing their things, having babies. So from a restoration standpoint, the idea is to get more of these fish into the Clark Fork, we need to connect those spawning and rearing habitats up in tributaries with the Clark Fork. And one of the approaches that we with our partners try to do is use fish screens. So fish screens are structures that are designed to keep fish out of irrigation canals. This is a picture of one here. It's a long flat plate screen. You're looking downstream into the irrigation canal, basically. And they're meant to keep fish out of these canals. A good example of that is this Allendale fish screen up on Flint Creek. It's actually a series of four different fish screens on four different ditches off of Flint Creek. And what FWP is doing is they're putting tags and fish all throughout Flint Creek and the Clark Fork River, and are actually doing work on Cottonwood Creek as well. And they're putting tags in called pit tags. These are passive integrated transponders. So they're passive, so they have to pass by one of these antennas that FWP is putting out to be detected. They have an individual ID, and they have to come within about a couple feet of these antennas. And so FWP has a couple of these antennas in Flint Creek and then also all around the Allendale fish screen. And like I said, they put tags out all over the place, but they tagged a number of West Slope cutthroat in the Clark Fork River, just both upstream and downstream of Flint Creek, and waited till May and June when cutthroat go to spawn to see where they went, to see, well, maybe some of these fish go over to Flint Creek. And lo and behold, in 2021, few of these fish did move into Flint Creek past their lowermost antenna. A few days later, a couple of fish went up past Allendale. There's a huge spawn somewhere up there, Boulder Creek perhaps, and then were successfully moved downstream past this fish screen, essentially saved by this fish screen from going into the canal. So I know it's only two fish, but out of about 70 cutthroat tagged, the chances that those two fish would go to spawn in Flint Creek, move up past Allendale, and be bypassed by that screen. I'd call that, you know, a successful couple data points. So that's the whole story I'm going to tell you in terms of the data we have right now. Caleb and his crew and others at FWP are spending a lot of time focusing on this component, the fish component. So trying to get their hands on more fish, smaller fish, to understand exactly what this recruitment limitation looks like. Like I said, we're working with the university on community composition. We're doing repeating the otolith study to look at life history. And we're planning more and more fish studies. Caleb is really busy, and he's going to continue to be busy for this foreseeable future. But there's all these other limiting factors that come into play that, you know, come to bear down on the population. And it looks like, you know, one or two of these things is having a really profound, dramatic negative influence on the population. I mean, we don't know which one exactly it is. But given the history of that fishery and its dependence on water quality, I put my fingers around water quality. That's not to say these other things aren't important, because they certainly are, but we won't see responses, you know, to restoring those things through cleanup and through restoration until we can identify, you know, that smoking gun, or maybe there's a couple smoking guns out there. But the good news is for this population is they've shown that they can be resilient in the past. And so if we can identify, you know, the important limiting factors, these fish populations will respond accordingly. That's my last slide.
Next up is Caleb. I'm supposed to tell them what's going on. It's my job.
What job?
Yes. All right, yeah, I'm going to talk about fisheries on Silverboat Creek. I'm going to skip through a lot of the start of this because I think it's already been covered and the folks in the room already know a lot of it. But yeah, I'm Caleb Erling, fisheries biologist with Fish, Wildlife and Parks, working on the Upper Clark Fork. Yeah, this is kind of the part I'm going to skip past, but just sort of some of the history of Silverboat Creek, how it ended up, you know, lots of tailings in Butte. Those are getting mixed in with water from Silverboat Creek going downstream, left Silverboat Creek heavily contaminated with these sediments and really fishless and pretty much lifeless from a aquatic standpoint for well over a century. Yeah, again, largely due to the tailings that made their way downstream. So I'll kind of start off here, maybe. To remedy that situation and the damages, the state filed a lawsuit against the Atlantic Richfield Company in the 80s. Around the same time, the Silverboat Creek and the rest of the Upper Clark Fork was designated a Superfund site. And I think the important thing from this is if you look, you know, at the different sub areas that were remedial on Silverboat Creek, sub area 1 through 4, they sort of started upstream in 1999 and finished that one up in the early 2000s, 2003. And then they moved down to the sub area 2 right here, Ramsey area. Remediated that from 2004 to 2010, and then finally sub area 3 in Durant Canyon around German Gulch was finished up in 2015. So these are kind of important dates, I guess, in context of the fishery as we move forward. So to give some background on the fishery in the basin, you know, all of Silverboat Creek from Butte all the way down to the Warm Springs ponds was fishless for, like I said, well over 100 years, or a little over 100 years. But fish species remained isolated in the various tributaries, primarily Blacktail Creek, Basin Creek, Browns Gulch, and German Gulch. But the kind of three that think about the most are Blacktail Creek, Browns Gulch, and German Gulch, as they're kind of the most connected. The Silverboat Creek, and in Blacktail Creek, the lower end is primarily brook trout, high densities of brook trout, like right down here in Butte, up through the golf course. And then as you get out past the 9 mile, it's about a 50-50 cutthroat brook trout split. But we do see cutthroat in Blacktail Creek on occasion, like all the way down into town. Browns Gulch is a little bit the same situation, comes in right by Ramsey. And the low, well, actually the whole stream is got high densities of brook trout, and they make up the majority of the fish population. And then kind of this middle section in here, there tends to be more cutthroat. And then upper reach is mostly brook trout again. And we do on occasion again see cutthroat like all the way down in these lower reaches of Browns Gulch, but very limited densities. And then sort of the really important one to Silverboat Creek is German Gulch. Comes in a few miles upstream of like the Fairmont Road in Durant Canyon.
There's brook trout present throughout German Gulch, but really high densities of cutthroat. All the way, you know, from upper German Gulch right down to the mouth where it joins up with Silverboat Creek, and likely was the case, you know, for a long time. And, you know, it runs through kind of a canyon or a steep valley all the way down to Silverboat Creek. So it's just less impacted by, you know, dewatering and running through a city and stuff like that. So just a little bit higher quality fishery there with a lot of native West Slope cutthroat trout. And now to get on to kind of the early fisheries and the background for Silverboat Creek. So if you recall, this subarea one, upper Silverboat Creek, they started on that in 1999. Water quality improved, and in 2002, Fish, Wildlife, and Parks found suckers and sculpin in that upper reach of Silverboat Creek. So those were the first fish, and then we continued doing monitoring, you know, basically going forward from there to monitor kind of how the fishery responded to this remediation. And again, in 2002, found those suckers and sculpin. 2003 to 2004, we expanded sampling to include some new sections, but no fish were observed in those new sections. Those sections were sections further downstream from Butte. In 2005, we started sampling Blacktail Creek at Father Sheehan Park, observed really high densities of brook trout and cutthroat every now and then. By 2006, the first trout was found in fall sampling in Silverboat Creek. It was a brook trout captured right at the mouth of German Gulch. Likely came out of German Gulch into Silverboat Creek. And then by 2007, the first West Slope cutthroat trout was found at that same site, right at the mouth of German Gulch there. And then we started observing brook trout further upstream at that LAO site, so like at the treatment facility in Butte and then at Ramsey. And then we added a new site down here in 2008, monitoring kind of that lower, those lower sections of remediation. We found rainbow trout coming up out of the Warm Springs ponds. And by 2010, so again, if you remember back to that map, by then a lot of this, you know, Silverboat Creek from German Gulch upstream was remediated. We had trout observed in all of these sampling sections from LAO right in Butte all the way down. And then in 2014, there was a fish barrier constructed right above Fairmont Road. And the intention there was basically because of the, you know, the chemical barrier that had kept fish out of Silverboat Creek for so long, when it was repopulated by these fish from German Gulch and the various other tributaries, those were brook trout and then genetically unaltered West Slope cutthroat trout. So we wanted to protect those from rainbows moving upstream and hybridizing with those West Slope cutthroat trout and also brown trout that were stocked in the Warm Springs ponds at the time moving up and inhabiting and competing in Silverboat Creek. And then from 2015 to 2020, we kind of intensified our sampling, trying to, rather than just documenting, you know, these periodic fish occurrences, we were trying to get population estimates or an abundance of the number of trout that were out there, as well as look at seasonal differences that were occurring in the fishery that we were starting to recognize from various studies that were going on. West Slope cutthroat trout and brook trout now exist throughout all of Silverboat Creek. However, they've always been in low densities. So they did kind of climb in densities in those early years, but we've never had real high densities of any trout in any of the reaches of Silverboat Creek, other than kind of right around German Gulch. Rainbow trout are primarily in the lower reaches of Silverboat Creek, associated with the Warm Springs ponds. And then brown trout are largely absent. We did capture one, I think, by Rocker Ramsey in 2016. And we took that one out of the system and haven't documented any since. And then we have sucker sculpin, central mud minnow and red side shiners are pretty prevalent all throughout Silverboat Creek. Especially sucker and sculpin. And we did some radio telemetry work in 2012 and 2013 that showed that trout presence in a lot of Silverboat Creek due to various factors was seasonal. So they were using parts of the creek, or they were kind of using the whole creek in the less harsh months, winter, fall, early spring. And then during the summertime when conditions would get harsh, they would kind of move out a lot of the creek for the most part and just occupy a few sections. So yeah, all the sampling that we're doing was electrofishing using primarily backpack electrofishing units. And we're getting, the data we're getting was catch punit effort data, which is just you go through a section, capture fish, and then you divide the number of fish you captured by the amount of effort. In this case, minutes of shocking to get your catch per unit of effort. And then also depletions. And a depletion is where you go through the same section multiple times. You in theory get fewer fish each time. You fit those values to a curve and you can estimate the number of fish in a section. So like if you get 20 the first time through and 5 the second time through, 1 the third time through, you're just fitting those values to a curve and estimating the number of fish in the section. Again, these are the sections we're doing that monitoring at. We did switch some of these lower sections, so these two around the fish barrier, to a larger electrofishing unit, barge electrofisher, and start doing mark and recapture estimates in 2020. And the reason we did that was these were never, it's kind of big water for backpack electrofishers down there, and it always was. But with the addition of the treated Berkeley pit water, then there was even more water, and then it was at a really high conductivity, which the higher conductivity is, kind of the less effective electrofishing is, especially when you're using a gear like a backpack or electrofisher that maybe wasn't all that efficient in those reaches to start with. And that's kind of important as we look at the data, just to realize that, you know, when we're looking at data from these two sections, that we switched gears in 2020, and those data aren't apples to apples necessarily. This is just a photo of that barge electrofishing unit. Now to look at some of our fish data from Silverboat Creek. I'm just going to show a few sections, but we'll start with the data from LAO Lower Area 1. So the treatment, the water treatment facility right downstream of Sidewall Canyon or Montana Street. And again, we're looking at catch punit effort data here. So fish captured per minute of electrofishing on the y-axis, year on the x-axis, and then you know, our two species that we have, cutthroat is the blue, breakout are the orange line. And basically what you see here is that there's always fish at this section, but always in low densities. And so these are like really low value. These are really low values here, you know, like 0.1 to 0.2 fish per minute. So we're shocking like 5 to 10 minutes per fish we capture in that reach. We'll get streams where you might have, you know, as high as 3 to 10 fish per minute, you know, in some streams. So really low densities, but there's generally always a few cutthroat and brook trout there. Kind of been variable through time, but really just at these low densities, with the exception, I guess, of this one year, we caught a lot of brook trout. And then next we'll look at the Ramsey section. This is a section that we have good annual data for. And basically what we saw, so again, fish kind of showed up in this 2007 time period. Cutthroat trout went up to some of the higher densities anywhere on Silverboat Creek, but again, relatively low densities. And then since peaking in like 2011, 2012, they've just kind of worked their way down. And then, you know, we really started to see a decline by 2020, you know, we caught one fish, and then 2021 and 2022, we didn't catch any cutthroat in that section. Brook trout have kind of just remained variable and at low densities in that section. So we still are seeing brook trout here and there in that section, but it's really, when you're looking at this data, realize these are like very few individuals. It might be like a couple fish in a couple hundred meter section. So really low densities. And then obviously this is concerning. We saw this ramp up in cutthroat numbers, and then it crashed right back down to to zero where we've been at the last couple of years. So I'm pretty concerned about that. And then this area, so kind of from Ramsey or little or Rocker or in the Rocker area down to about Miles Crossing or a little below Miles Crossing, the fishery is very seasonal. So we were seeing, in the fall, basically there would be trout there. And then by the summertime, conditions had got too harsh and trout had moved out of the area. That's what this data is showing here. And basically just, if you look at the summer points, there's really not, in 2018 there was, because that was a good water year, but like in 2016 and 2017, there really weren't trout in the section in the summer. And then these bigger bars in between are the fall points. So those fish had moved back in the fall. This is some other data to show that. So this graph is from the fall. This graph is the same section in the summer. And so we just really weren't seeing trout in that kind of middle silver bow during the summer months. And then the last section I'll show is a section that we do right below German Gulch. So we pretty much start right at German Gulch and go downstream a little ways. This is the one where we switched gear types in 2020, but kind of what you see is that numbers have been really variable through time. But sometimes when densities of cutthroat were a little higher and brook trout as well, tended to be kind of like the higher density section on the stream. Unfortunately, we switched gears in 2020, right when we kind of saw that decline in the rest of Silver Bow Creek. So it's hard to know what happened at German Gulch. Kind of anecdotally, we think the numbers declined there to lots of kind of poor reports from anglers. And then, the barge is a much more efficient gear at capturing fish. And these were our most recent data points, catch punitive effort data points from that site. So in theory, the barge is much more effective at catching fish than the backpack electric fishers were, but we're still getting catch punitive effort values that are right kind of in the range of what we had historically got at that section. So kind of anecdotally, we think the numbers declined there, but again, we switched our gears right when the decline in kind of middle Silver Bow Creek happened, so we're not exactly sure. So I basically just told you that fish densities are really low on Silver Bow Creek and somewhat variable. And then over the last few years, we've seen this big decline where all of our sections that we do basically from Rocker down to German Gulch have very few or no trout in them. And so now we're going to get into some of the limiting factors for trout in Silver Bow Creek. And these graphs I'm going to show you were data collected by Raja Nagasendi from Montana. He's a professor at Montana Tech and shared this data with us to use in this presentation. So, these graphs with kind of the colored lines here are all data him and one of his students, Kyle, collected. You don't need to pay too much attention to the various colors, but basically on these graphs, as you move from green to like hotter colors to red, you're moving downstream. And really the point here is just to show that Silver Bow Creek gets really warm. So, all of these values here are in that 20 to 25 degrees Celsius range. That's really warm for trout. Kind of a couple important thresholds for trout. So inside the green bar there is kind of optimal temperature for West Slope cutthroat trout. That's when they're going to have the highest survival rates and be growing at the highest rate. So, obviously in the summertime, we're only in that range at the coolest point of the day. These diurnal fluctuations, you see, that's just your daily fluctuation in temperature each day. And then an incipient lethal temperature is about 19 degrees for cutthroat trout. And so they're not going to die just if they're exposed to 19 degrees Celsius, but they're essentially dying. So they'll quit growing and their body's kind of just shutting down. And so if exposed to those temperatures for long enough, they will die. And that same temperature for our non-native species like brook trout and brown trout is kind of more in this 22 to 25 and a half degree range. The point here is that Silver Bow Creek You know, this is just a sample from about a month last summer, but this is really typical, kind of happens every summer where we get these temperatures that are, you know, really getting to ranges that are unsuitable for trout, definitely unsuitable for cutthroat trout. So temperature is probably the biggest limiting factor that we got. The next one would be dissolved oxygen. It's tied to temperature. This graph is obviously a little messy here, but dissolved oxygen is either as big or a bigger limiting factor for fish in Silverbow Creek as temperature. Again, you see these diurnal fluctuations where dissolved oxygen is going from you know, this 4 range up to, you know, 12 to 14. For trout, kind of the critical point is 4. If you're getting below 4, you're not going to have trout that can't survive in water less than 4. And then really 6 is kind of the minimum we think of for kind of normal trout function and having trout. So if you're getting below that 6 mark, it's not likely you're going to have much for trout. And as you can see, Silverbow Creek, especially kind of, again, that middle area of Silverbow Creek, like from LAO down to Miles Crossing, tends to get really low dissolved oxygen down in that 4 to 6 range normally. Probably a big limiting factor for trout. Then another one is conductivity. We don't know if this is a limiting factor or if it's affecting fish, but it's certainly something we want to learn a little bit more about. I just have 2 points on here. So the yellow is LAO, kind of that orangish color is down at Miles Crossing. And I just picked this date range kind of to give an example of what we're seeing for conductivity. The normal background level at LAO for conductivity was already really high. So it was already like 400 was the background level. In trout streams in Western Montana, we see values from like the teens, so like 15 to 20, all the way up to Silverbow Creek was kind of right at the upper end. We'll see values like in the Clark Fork and some other tributaries, kind of in that 300 to 500 range, which was right about where Silverbow Creek was. But in trout waters in Western Montana, we don't see anything, you know, just background natural levels higher than that. Obviously, when the treated pit water started, those levels went up, and at LAO, they kind of, we tend to see them in the, when we're out there, and yeah, the 14 to 1600 range. We don't really know if that is an issue for trout. Like I said, we don't see it in background conditions, so it's just something we want to know more about. There's really no indication that it is an issue for trout, at least with the sulfates and calcium that are making up the total dissolved solids that are causing this high conductivity. But one thing we've been working with Montana Resources and ARCO on is this time period is actually from when Mark talked about they were turning the discharge on at night and off during the day. So you basically see at LAO, you know, drop at in the daytime when they turn it off, it would drop back down to this normal range for Silverbow Creek of about 500. And then when they would turn it back on, they would go up to 1600. And so we were concerned about, you know, can fish osmoregulate when those values are changing so fast? And, you know, is it hurting fish to have these values going up and down really fast? And so he talked about that they turned the discharge off. That's at this point. So then you kind of see a flat line in that normal range. And then so we've also been working with them when they do need to turn off the discharge, if it's kind of a controlled event that they know is coming, to step it down so we don't see these big dramatic fall offs in flow and conductivity, that it would be a gradual decline. And so again, we don't know if conductivity is an issue for fish. Like I said, it's something we would want to know more about, but would maybe take like a lab study combined with kind of a field study to understand it a little bit better. But it's a variable that's changed in Silverbow Creek and one that we're kind of monitoring and interested in, I guess. Habitat quality is certainly a limiting factor in Silverbow Creek. So there's kind of a whole bunch of things going on that limit habitat quality. You know, it navigates a lot of infrastructure, whether that's Butte infrastructure, interstates. There's two rail lines that run the length of Silver Bow Creek that sometimes have it kind of running in just a straight shot that doesn't provide a lot of fish habitat. And then, you know, the whole stream was remediated, and that remediation, there's kind of a spectrum out there of habitat quality. From areas like this where the vegetation didn't, you know, riparian vegetation didn't really take, and you kind of have like a wide, slow moving, stream that has no riparian vegetation that forms habitat, to stuff like this where it looks a little bit better, but again, not a lot of riparian vegetation. This is mostly like more upland grasses and stuff like that. And then you get areas, you know, that are a little better where the willows came in good, and we have good willow recruitment and habitat starting to form. So kind of the whole spectrum out there as it relates to the remediation, and certainly it's getting better over time, but there's a lot of areas out there that are pretty bare as far as fish habitat goes still. Contamination, I think there's still some groundwater contamination in some areas of Silver Bow Creek. And then there's a few hot spots left out there where contamination has popped back up, but likely not a big limiting factor for fish, I don't think, but certainly still a little bit of contamination out there that could be impacting fish. Then connectivity in the drainage is something that we always think about with cutthroat especially. And then, you know, I talked about Silver Bow Creek, where these fish are moving around the stream seasonally. They're going into tributaries to spawn. It's really important that they can make all those movements and that the stream has good connectivity. So, you know, there's been various diversions addressed in the drainage with fish screens. And diversion improvements. So a really big one that was done by Trout Unlimited was there is a diversion right at the mouth of German Gulch. They got that diversion screened, and you know, the majority of the fish coming into Silver Bow Creek are coming you know, either through that fish screen or over that diversion most likely. But there's still some issues out there. So there's a couple sets of these side by side culverts that DEQ put in. Probably around 2009 as temporary crossings. And those are still out there. This is one that we came on this fall. This is the downstream side, and this is the upstream side. So total fish barrier. And this happens to be kind of right between Ramsey and Miles Crossing. So it's right in that really critical area where fish are trying to go there during one time of the year and leave during another time of the year. And it's a total fish barrier. There's another one down in German Gulch, again, kind of in like this critical area where these cutthroat are making migratory movements for spawning and for refuge habitat. Luckily, I think DEQ, you know, once we sort of made them aware of the issue here, I think they're going to take care of this and either take these out completely or replace them with bridges this fall. So hopefully kind of get some of these last connectivity issues in the drainage wrapped up. And then spawning habitat and recruitment source, the last big limiting factor. So again, our data suggests that most of the fish in Silver Bow Creek come from German Gulch, kind of the high quality tributary. So we have all this, you know, stream mileage of Silver Bow Creek, and the only fish are pretty much coming from German Gulch for the most part, especially for cutthroat trout. And so, you know, restoration in these tributaries and hopefully getting some recruitment out of those tributaries is really important and likely a little bit of a limiting factor. It's just a source of fish right now. And so to, you know, to look at some of these limiting factors and how they're impacting fish, we're doing a telemetry project right now. Telemetry is where we put an acoustic tag in fish, and then we use a radio receiver to go locate the fish falling around the creek. And learn about, you know, where they're running into issues with movement. The main goal of that effort is determine if cutthroat trout are using other tributaries other than German Gulch. Our first telemetry study suggested they only were spawning in German Gulch, but it was really early on when remediation was actually still going on a little bit on Silver Bow Creek. And so that may have changed. We do see cutthroat trout in those other tributaries and in the lower end on occasion. And then the big one is determine where trout are finding refuge from unsuitable temperature and dissolved oxygen conditions. We know that a lot of Silver Bow Creek is not habitable for them during the summer months. We know they go to a couple areas, but we think there could be some other areas that they're going to out there. So we want to understand where they're going to get refuge from those habitat and see if there's things we can do to help them out there. And then we'll get some information on mortality. So when and where are fish dying in Silverbow Creek? You know, are they getting stuck in a barrier and dying from high temperatures? Are they just dying from high temperatures in general? You know, predation from various things. So get some information on mortality. And then just understanding general movement patterns of trout in Silverbow Creek kind of throughout the entire year. So how are they making those seasonal movements? Are they running into any issues when they try to do that? And then the same thing for the spawning movements. So we electrofished most of Silverbow Creek and surgically implanted 38 tags that were paid for by the local George Grant Trout Unlimited chapter. Here's just like a, I'll just roll through these quick, but just an example of that surgery. So it's a little 2 or 4 gram tag. We make a small incision at the front end of the fish. And then we put this metal tool down through the fish. It's kind of got a groove in it that we then find with this needle here, and then run the needle up that metal groove kind of from the back end of the fish here. So this is a photo where this metal tool is in the fish, and then you can see the needle sticking out the back end. Run the antenna that you see here through that needle out the back end of the fish, pull the 2 tools out, which is what has happened here. And then he's got the tag in this hand and the antenna in this hand, and he's going to slide that tag into the fish, and it'll end up resting right on top of these pelvic fins here. And then stitch the fish back up with staples and send them on their way, and then we'll follow them around. Again, paid for by George Grant Trout Unlimited. This is sort of our tag distribution that we have right now. This first year, we're going to be focusing most of the tags kind of in this area where we don't have a lot of fish and where those fish are clearly running into some issues. And then next year, we might move some of those tags down in the lower Silverbow Creek. Yeah, we put out all 38 tags. So far, we've had 5 mortalities associated with the tagging, which is, I think, pretty average for the number of tags that we have out. And then we'll follow the rest of the fish around as they make spawning movements and movements related to temperature, dissolved oxygen, habitat flows, all sorts of different things. Track the fish for 1 to 2 years till the tags die. And then we have a couple technicians at FWP that have worked really hard on this project and done a lot of the legwork. And so, that's one project we're doing on Silverbow Creek to try to evaluate some of those limiting factors. There's a couple other things that we've got in the hopper as well, but that's sort of one that's happening right now, I guess. That's all I've got.
Thanks for holding the questions. If we can have our presenters come up and maybe Caleb, do you want to just pull that table off? Get one fish guy each table. Is it okay? It's 8:30, so I promised a couple guys a beer after this. So if you have a really burning question, go ahead. And thank you guys for your presentation. Really great work and some great minds working on together on the problem here. So I think it's just great that we had this forum and appreciate all the work you guys are doing. So anybody in the room?
What happened? Did
you state your name?
Chris Boyette. What happened in 2015, fish-wise, I'm going to stand up so I can see all of you, but Caleb and Nathan, I saw both of your presentations a few weeks ago, and this was stuck in my head because I was not here at that year, and so what was the event in 2015 around here?
For the big decline on the Clark Fork you're asking
Clark
about.
Fork, but also I saw it up on your presentation on the Silverbow.
Yeah. I don't know that there's any, the Clark Fork, I don't know that there was anything specific. That was just kind of when the decline started, and it's just continued or gotten worse since, so. I'm not sure that there was anything specific to 2015. There were a couple flow years prior to that that weren't great. Can't think of which ones exactly off the top of my head.
13 was a low flow, hot fall that started, that did the decline and brown shot in the big hole.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, Silverboat Creek is probably, yeah, it could have been.
14.
Low flow, hot conditions are certainly a big factor on Silverboat Creek, so.
One of the factors on the Clark Fork is that 2013 and 2014 were good years, population wise, because of flows previously. And then we got some bad flow years, population went down and they just never came back up.
So 2011 was like a historic flow year, and then in that, yeah, 3 years later, basically, all around the Clark Fork, like all the way down, even at that like Williams Tavernier section that he showed, we saw like these historically high numbers that then came kind of back down to reality after that too, so.
You guys done any correlations? I mean, the Big Hole River and the brown trout, it's been a problem. The Beaverhead's the same way. And it seems to be occurring at the same time. So I'm wondering if there's, you know, obviously there's something we're not.
Yeah, some of those have, and so like the Beaverhead, I think the Ruby, some of them have started to kind of come back up. The Big Hole, the Clark Fork has continued to go down. The Big Hole came back up a little bit, and now it's still pretty stable at like low levels for the Big Hole, I think. We did a big statewide brown trout study a couple of years back where we tried to look at like lots of variables that we thought might be factors for all of these various waters that we were seeing brown trout declines on. Nothing came from that study that, you know, had any statistical significance to it. I mean, there were a few variables for a few water bodies that had some significance to them, but there was no connection, you know, there's no common variable among the basins, and there was nothing to the Clark Fork or the Big Hole that really stood out specifically from that.
So you probably looked at if there's any biological issues or something.
We've done disease testing on both the Clark Fork and the Big Hole, and we haven't found anything. We did have a little bit of a fungus outbreak on the Clark Fork 2 years ago, but it was after the numbers had already declined a bunch. But yeah, no, they are doing. We have some new methods for disease testing that I think they sampled some fish on the Big Hole for last year, and they're going to be sampling around the rest of the state this year for, I think. So still looking at the disease thing, it's certainly still a possibility, and you wonder with the proximity of it, of course. And obviously, if you don't know how to look, if it's something new that we don't know how to look for, then that gets tricky, but yeah.
So I recall some of the dates that were put on the remediation efforts. The remediation of the Silverboat Creek finished in 2015. Presumably the last piece was the Durant Canyon piece, or was it somewhere else?
Yeah. No, it's Durant Canyon.
Yeah. So I don't know if ending remediation, you know, makes the difference. That fish barrier was put in somewhere right at German Gulch.
Mm-hmm.
Some point around there. I mean, I don't remember what year exactly that was. And a lot of the remediation stretches on the Clark Fork. You know, I don't know when all they were going on, but you showed, I think, dates that various different remediations were going on. And, you know, I don't, so doing remediation on a stretch of creek or river must mess up more river, particularly downstream, because maybe they put it all in a pipe and it, you know, goes around and they work on it then. But or they're, you know, digging it up and building things, and they probably do that very well when the water is flowing to where they're working. I have no idea whether the actual remediation activity in certain stretches of river are affecting the migration of fish up and down, or the quality of water that the fish get.
Yeah, I think I'll take a stab at it. Nathan can add too. He has it. I think it's important that they're a little different because on Silverboat Creek, the fish were basically showing up in response to the remediation. As they remediated a stretch, then kind of fish started to show up. And then as they finished up, those numbers were peaking. And then after they were gone was when they came back down. I don't know that there's, I don't think there's any real connect. If anything, things should be getting better as we get further from remediation. I think on the Clark Fork, yeah, they are remediating in water that has fish, and there certainly are short-term impacts to that, but I don't think there's impacts to the level that we see. Some remediation did happen, you know, around the time that those numbers declined, but I don't think that just the habitat and, you know, the little bit of kind of stirring things up there have happening are solely responsible for that decline, but it certainly is a factor in the short term. And then you mentioned the barrier. That's one thing we're going to hopefully look at with the telemetry data is like, are we losing, you know, it's been suggested that we could fish might go over the barrier, not be able to get back up, and you're just, then you're just losing fish to the population above the barrier all the time. And we don't really see that in our data. Like, we don't see like tons and tons and tons of fish stacked up like right at the barrier trying to get back up necessarily, but telemetry tagging fish would be a really good way to find out. And so as we transition to moving tags down there next year, I think we'll be able to answer that question pretty well. I don't know if you have anything to add on the remediation side.
No, I think you nailed it. I think, you know, we expected to see some disturbance and some, you know, impact of the fish population, but the level, you know, down to 25 fish per mile in what looks like pretty good habitat currently just doesn't add up.
And another thing, fish are really good at, they're mobile. They find habitat. Like if Trout Unlimited comes in and does a habitat restoration project, you can come in almost like right behind them and see higher fish numbers because they just suck into that habitat. And when we saw that decline, it kind of happened most dramatically up near like Warm Springs, but all the way down to Deer Lodge. It didn't really matter if we were looking in a remediated area or unremediated area, good habitat, bad habitat, there just aren't fish really anywhere in there in any significant, you know, abundance.
And in the early years of the remediation in the Clark Fork, we actually had fish cages out there above and below the remediation to see if it was impacting the survival of those fish, kind of canaries in the cone. Didn't see any, you know, acute impacts from the restructuring.
So how about like macro invertebrates? Are you looking at those kind of at the same time as fish? Have we seen those numbers drop? Is there a correlation there at all?
That's a great question. It's not something that I work on personally or Caleb does, but DEQ does a lot of macroinvertebrate sampling. USGS does it every year. University system's got a big macroinvertebrate study. And the trends generally show, you know, especially in Silverboat Creek, a big benefits to remediation. So not all intolerant species have come back, and that same goes true in the Clark Fork River. One thing that's kind of shown up, you know, as these metal intolerant species have kind of come back, is potentially other impacts are kind of showing their head, their face, yeah, showing their face, particularly like nutrient impacts. So there's a signal of that showing up in the benthic macroinvertebrate communities, but looking at those data sets at face value, things are getting better ecologically in the system, but not for fish for some reason.
So how about the area that you showed and looked like kind of by Ramsey there where you had some contaminated water coming out in those ponds? Is there any plans to go back and try to remediate any of that stuff?
I think they have. They've spotted remediated some of it from time to time. I don't know like what the ongoing.
I think they're done. They're done.
It's pretty sparse at this point. And that surface level contamination is pretty sparse. There is, I think they do see some, I think starting below downstream of the LAO somewhere, maybe in the rocker area, that you start to see some metals coming up in groundwater. But I don't think it's anything that's like at a level that we'd expect major impacts to fisheries, but I think they do see, I'm talking a little bit out of my wheelhouse here, but.
There's actually, it's getting very narrowed down. So between two stations that were, say, 4 miles apart, they've now done synoptic sampling and they've got it narrowed down to about a half mile section. And it is a pretty substantial jump in copper.
Any sort of plans then, Joe, to go address that?
I think it's still in motion, but I don't work for DEQ anymore. So. No, it is. They're trying to, I think they'll be addressing it, but there's so many new people, EPA and DEQ and stream side tailings, so all new faces. They're going to have to figure out what they're going to do there.
Question, have you guys looked at Butte Metro? Because Butte Metro's new plant came online exactly when that fish population cratered. Have you guys done any looking at what the discharge of Metro is looking like?
Yeah, we haven't at FWP specifically. And you know, I know they've reduced nutrients a little bit, and that does seem that those dissolved oxygen values I showed have actually improved a little bit over what they historically, it was actually getting down to like almost zero in maybe about 10 years ago. And so those have gotten a little bit better maybe in response to the upgrades there. But outside of that, you know, as far as like other water, I don't have a good background.
We saw a difference in the microbial metagenomic data above and below and before and after that came online, right, Paul?
Absolutely. We were able to see a really stark change in the community dynamic within like 2 or 3 months of that upgrade coming online. So we think that certainly when the upgrade came online, there was a change in the geochemistry of the creek that began to foster certain groups of microbial life in the area below it.
I can tell you quite a bit about it, actually. For one thing, it reduced the level of copper in the creek incredibly. So it wasn't designed to take out copper, but it did. It used to be the single largest tributary source of copper, and it now is dilution. So it reduces copper levels. It used to be downstream because of the ammonia coming out of there. There was an area where DO got down to 1 milligram per liter and even a little lower. Chris Gammons called it the death zone because it truly, actually, suckers seem to manage to live through it down there. But somebody asked about macroinvertebrate studies. There's been a long-term macroinvertebrate study started by Dan McGuire, and it's now been picked up by David Stagliano. And he did both they both have a metals indices, but they also had a nutrient indices. And it was pretty cool to see the nutrient indices just come right back up. Right after 2016, it started to jump up, and it's now in slightly impaired, and those are kind of random categories, but they have slightly impaired to maybe unimpaired.
So this is an interesting correlation between new plant and collapse of the trout species downstream.
Yeah, I don't
trout numbers. So downstream.
I would guess it's coincidental personally. But it certainly made improvements in what was affecting fish, certainly from the ammonia standpoint.
Did you have something else on that?
I was actually going to change the topic.
Okay.
I'll let you guys.
No, go ahead.
Oh, so just talking about some of the brown trout numbers that you guys have seen, I realized that I'm the first person to cry fish disease. I did both my bachelor's and my master's on PKD, on the T. brevis salmonae, but
you know, really what you said about the brown trout numbers being related to whitefish really sets that alarm off in my mind, because PKD is the killer of whitefish, 100%. And it does concern me, because I've worked with Taylor too. I'm looking forward to looking for PKD and all those kidneys. That's going to be great. But it concerns me that the main way that we're looking for something like that is in the fish themselves. And the reason that I say that is because you brought it up. We can basically sample age 3 and above fish. But if we really believe that this is something that has to do with recruitment and potentially with disease, the mortality that could be occurring is below age 3. And certainly with PKD going on in Europe, what they see there is the frying is what are going to die. So it concerns me to think we could go up and down all these rivers in Western Montana, cutting open adult fish and not seeing disease, right? Because maybe that is somewhere else. And talking about the big hole and the beaverhead, my bachelor's was on the beaverhead and my master's was on the big hole, looking for disease in the water itself. And we find it every time. Every time, especially in the beaverhead, at 5 sites below the Clark Fork Dam, 100% of the time we pick it. And on the big hole, there is a spatial trend, and or excuse me, a temporal trend, but it's certainly there. So I really, that really just set my mind going when you said there's a relationship between brown trout mortality and whitefish mortality, because if there's whitefish mortality, that's something you need to think about.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'd still like to pick your brain more about the fish we send in for disease analysis. Did they look at PKD?
Yeah,
this is a few years back.
Yeah, and they were adults, like you're suggesting. Sure. I guess the interesting thing to think about would be if something would have changed with PKD around that time period, because you know, like you're talking about that there's some areas where we routinely see in the water column PKD
absolutely
present. And I think some of that's, or some, we have water bodies that PKD is kind of ever present and just
really in Western Montana, wherever we look for it,
right?
It appears to be there.
And so is there, I guess the question is like, is there a stressor that has caused it to become really prolific in sure. those young age class fish over recent, you know, basically since we saw that decline, or the presence of PKD isn't new, but is something else influencing its presence, I guess, and how prolific it is.
Absolutely. I totally agree. I mean, it is a native species here in Montana. There's no reason to think that it's been introduced beyond normal movement of fish. But you know, I'm all about interaction between variables. That's a huge interest of mine when we're talking about statistics. And when you put up the flow, and then you put up this relationship between brown trout mortality and whitefish mortality, I mean, PKD is the smoking gun with it. Every time that there is disease, it's always temperature, because it causes that cascading immune response that is the disease process. So when I see low flows and low mountain whitefish, maybe that's just a correlation. That's certainly a possibility, because this is a big question, but I really think there's a possibility that there's some interaction going on, especially in the Clark Fork.
So would you guys let the engineers know what PKD is? You want me to
say that? Well, I would love to tell you. So PKD is a disease of salmonid fish. It stands for proliferative kidney disease. And essentially what happens is as I mentioned, native parasite belonging to called Myxozoans. It's the same group that
whorling disease falls into. Infects some monitored fish and travels to the tubules of their kidneys, where it mostly lays dormant until it's eventually passed out of the urine. However, it's thought that under stressful conditions, the replication of the parasite in the kidney tubules becomes out of control, and a massive immune response occurs in the fish, which causes their kidneys to kind of balloon up and die in the same way that humans die of fevers. Mountain whitefish die of BKD. And this caused, and the main reason that I started studying it is that I'm from Gardner, Montana. And in 2016, a mountain whitefish kill occurred near Gardner, 10,000 whitefish. And it's not really clear why this has happened. BKD wasn't necessarily well studied before this occurred. But as Caleb mentioned, everywhere we look for it in Montana, it is there. And likely has been for thousands of years. I don't want to overblow this because it's my main interest, right? So, of course, everywhere I look, I see pigeon. But it's insidious. You know, it's not clear why it happened in 2016. And despite the USGS and my best efforts over the past 5 years, couldn't predict it if it happened again. So it's a scary thing that's very much present everywhere we talk.
Well, let's follow up on that. Let's keep in touch. I'd like to pick your brain about how much PKD is too much PKD.
Oh, I could talk about this for the rest of the night. So that's awesome.
Those are all great presentations. Thank you. I just had a couple of quick questions for Mark.
I thought I was going to skate.
On the water temperature issue, has there been any consideration for trying to bury the transmission pipe from the tailings impoundment as a way to get some heat exchange with the ground?
We look closely at, temperature where we're pumping out of the pond, lake, temperature being received by the polisher plant, temperature coming out of the polisher plant, temperature at the discharge structure. And, because that pipeline is transporting not just the discharge water, but also the mill water, the velocity is very high.
Yeah.
It's 20 million gallons a day in a 30-inch pipe.
It's not enough contact time.
Okay. So it's screaming down. It's just screaming down that hill. And we see typically a degree to a degree and a half increase between the pond and what we deliver to the polishing plant. So if you think about it, you might be able to prevent a little of that. You're not going to get it all,
mm-hmm.
Maybe sure. To a degree. So, how much effort are you going to go after for a degree? And that's kind of how we view it.
I guess I just wondered if, that's how some cooling systems are in the desert countries. They basically, if you prevented a degree of heating and you added a degree of cooling, then maybe there would be some action to it. But
the thing we got to keep in mind as well is this temperature thing is just going to get worse as the pond volume decreases. The beach length that the tailings have to flow across increases. The amount of cycle that water's making through the mill increases. And then we just don't have that thermal mass anymore that we had at 34,000 acre feet that we're going to have 15,000 acre feet. So, I don't think the solution lies in a degree or two here or there. The solution is going to be just, Caleb and AR and MR have talked about is, tell us when you want us to quit, Because what's happening is the peak temperatures in the creek will rise faster than the pond will rise. So early summer, we're actually having a pretty good cooling effect on those peak temperatures. But then the temperatures start to cross and the low temperatures in the creek get to be lower than our temperature in the pond. Right. The pond, it was single temperature. And then once that crosses, that's when we're going to start yakking and, when's enough is enough. And
you know, with our system, we can do that. We just turn it off. And I think that's the key. I mean, that's one of the things you saw some of the graphs, you know, at certain points in those graphs in there, and even in your chemistry graphs, you know, we're three parts effluent to one part creek water in some of those graphs. I think that's one of the things we're learning. You can't do that.
Yeah.
You know, we went into it thinking, oh yeah, you know, as long as we meet those standards that we had listed, you know, we discharge all we want. Well, it's not that simple. I mean, that's the engineer versus the biologist, right? That's why I don't know what PKD is. But, you know, I think the simple fact is there's a lot of inputs into that creek. And it's a really small creek. And so, I mean, at the end of the day, that's what we've got. So if during these stressful periods, we can eliminate one presser because we can.
Sure.
Let's do it.
And then it's great news that you're meeting all the standards for contaminant concentrations. But there's also been some failures on effluent toxicity.
Yeah, and what tests? So.
Is that something that can be remedied with increased use of that RO facility?
You know, I've worked with whole effluent toxicity when I worked at the Red Dog Mine in Alaska, and now again here. And you're never going to get away from that, no matter what you do. It's just a factor of the test. Sometimes you're going to come up showing bad. I mean, if you run enough wet tests, you're going to fail, and that could be your tap water. That's just the way it is.
You're passing the test when the water's diluted, though, right? So I mean, it's basically as you get toward that whole effluent that they're starting to fail for reproduction. So
most of the time for reproduction, which is the chronic test, we never fail acute at end of pipe, and we always pass on the minnow species. Where we struggle with is the Ceridaphnia dubia, the invert, and they are fairly sensitive to calcium. We know that. But most of the time, most of our tests come back no chronic toxicity in the pipe. You know, sometimes we get tests back that no chronic toxicity at end of pipe, but within the mixing zone. You know, so you have to have the creek flow as well. And RO helps, but you know, when you got the type of hardness that we have in this effluent, it's you're always going to struggle having 100% passing on wet tests. It's just a very difficult test. Sensitivity within the species and the culture at each individual laboratory varies, and it's a very difficult test. But more RO does help. But when you look at the overall system, you know, the RO reject, which is the stuff that can't pass through the membrane, is we're about 35%. So when we pass something through RO, we've got 35% of whatever we pass through, there's a waste stream.